meeting for us tonight.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You may be seated. We will begin tonight's meeting, sadly, by remembering two students who lost their lives this year. Although we celebrate these lives and the positive impact these students made on the Guilford County Schools family, our hearts are extended in grief to their loved ones. On behalf of the Board of Education, we'd like to extend our deepest condolences to the families, friends, and teachers of Rontavion Porter and Amira Berry.
A Dudley High School student, Rontavion Porter,
can best be described as soft-spoken, kind-hearted, and respectful. He was admired by his peers and worked well with others. Rontavion also helped his peers in the classroom and was always encouraging to those around him. He will be greatly missed by the Dudley High family.
Jamestown Middle, and her smile could light up the room. She was a very intelligent student and able to apply her knowledge in the classroom. Amira was thoughtful and kind towards others. She was also liked by her peers and teachers. Our thoughts and prayers are with the Berry family.
While we were only privileged to know these students for a short period of time, in their own ways, they helped to create a heartwarming memories and a legacy that will be cherished forever. To honor these students and their families, please join me in a moment of silence. At this time, I'd like to invite family members and school representatives in attendance to come forward to receive our condolences personally from either these family, from both these families and these schools. So if any family members here, please come forward so we can express our condolences personally to you. Also school members as well. I always find it difficult to go on with the rest of the meeting after we honor these families and these students. And we do give great thanks for what they brought and for the time they had with us. And thank you to the families for being here tonight. Next tonight, we're going to honor a student who demonstrated outstanding leadership skills and received a national honor as a result. Will Hannah Robertson please come to the podium at this time? Hannah is a senior at Eastern Guilford High School, and she has the distinction of being named an International Leo of the Year Award winner by the Lions Club International. Hannah is one of only 13 people in the country and fewer than 40 in the world to receive this honor for 2016-17. So this is not just a national honor, this is a worldwide honor. During this accomplishment, Hannah had to demonstrate outstanding leadership skills, achieve a superior record as a Leo in implementing successful service projects, make an identifiable contribution to the development and growth in the Leo Club program, achieve distinction in community or school activities outside of the Leo Club commitments, and demonstrate high ethical standards and personal integrity. She was nominated by Eastern High Leo Club advisor Randall Clapp, who says she exemplifies the best in being a Leo member. She has served as president of the school Leo Club for the last 2 years and has helped club membership grow to 70 students. She implemented two Leo Club service projects at Eastern, a cleanup program that includes a campus cleanup day and weekly cleanup after all home football games. And I've been there, that's a lot of cleanup. Those hot dogs really are good, aren't they? The Leo Club also volunteers to help its sponsoring club, the McLeansville Lions Club, at its Brunswick Stews and Antique Tractor Shows. Hannah was chosen to represent her Lions Club district in the state of North Carolina. She will be receiving her medal and international recognition in January at the District Lions Convention. We are certainly very proud of Hannah for her commitment to service and for representing Guilford County Schools in such a fine way at the national level. At this time, I'd like to ask Board Member Pat Tillman to step down and present Hannah with a certificate of recognition for this outstanding achievement.
Hannah, on behalf of the Guilford County School Board and our Superintendent, Dr. Cheris, we are delighted to present you this certificate of recognition, not only here in Guilford County, but obviously you've done well here and abroad. So we're delighted to present this to you on behalf of our board and the community. And thanks for all your work, that all those hours, in addition to your schoolwork, is certainly not lost on us. And we want to celebrate you tonight. Thank you so much for your help.
Okay. I just want to say thank you to all of you, and I'm honored to represent our Leo Club and Eastern Guilford, and I'm thankful for the opportunities and experiences that I've been able to experience. So thank you.
Thank you. And at this time, we'd like you to, if your family members are here, or any of your school family members are here, we'd like to ask them to come join you, and we'd like to congratulate you personally on this wonderful recognition.
Congratulations, we're so proud of you.
That's right, congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Beautiful.
Congratulations.
We're so proud.
Thank you.
Very excited. Thank you so much for letting us have it. Thank you, sir.
I'm sorry.
I saw you soon.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's now time for public comments, and we have a number of speakers signed up tonight. Thank you in advance for taking your valuable time to share your thoughts with us. We really do appreciate it. Three quick rules as a reminder. The first one, if you could state your name and address, which will not count against your time, followed by you have 3 minutes to speak. And when 15 seconds is left, a yellow light will go off. And then shortly thereafter, a red light and an annoying beeping sound will start to occur. So that means your time's up. Because we have a lot of speakers, thank you very much for observing the time limits in advance. Also want to say, if any issues you have relate directly to a student or to a particular member of our personnel in the Guilford County Schools, we want to address those issues, and Nora Carr, Chief of Staff, is here. Please bring those to her attention. But we ask that you not address those in that manner from the podium because we have very strict confidentiality laws that apply to our student privacy information. In addition, we have both state and federal laws that apply to our personnel privacy as well. So please, we look forward to hearing your comments, and they're important for us to hear about education. But if your comments are that particularized, please bring them to Dr. Carr's attention. So our first speaker is Valerie Myrick, to be followed by Dr. Keith McCullough, an old board friend. Is Ms. Myrick here? Not seeing Ms. Myrick, then let's go to Dr. Keith McCullough, who will be followed by Cornelia Johnson. Good evening, Keith. It's good to see you.
Likewise, good evening. My name is Keith McCullough. I reside at 1309 Wendell Avenue, High Point, North Carolina. Today I come to represent a few concerned parents from Motlew Elementary School in High Point. And the concern deals with the traffic pattern when they pick their kids up in the afternoon. Generally during the morning time, there are no issues dropping their kids off. However, in the evening, it becomes an issue picking up the kids, as each parent has to arrive almost 45 minutes early to pick their child up in order to not deal with congestion in the parking lot. Where the parking lot is designed, it is part of a larger field, and the parking lot for the teachers. Parking is on both sides for the teachers, and the traffic pattern is in a loop, almost like a track-like formation. What happens is an initial line of traffic begins early, and then after that line reaches from the top of the school to the bottom of the hill, the traffic then reaches to the entrance. Other cars that come in after that point begin a second line inside a parking lot where there's already two rows of cars, so it's kind of tight for them to start another line. The issue becomes when the second line of cars start, they block the exit. So after a parent has picked up their kids, it becomes kind of difficult for them to exit. Prior to coming inside, I spoke with Mr. Trent. He wasn't aware of the situation, and he said he would look into the issue. But even with a traffic cop, I think it could resolve some of the issue, but I think possibly widening the entrance and perhaps placing a median there with directional arrows may make it a lot easier for people to get in and out of the parking lot. Again, I mean, it's not one of those issues where you know, students are having issue learning, but for parents, it has become pretty difficult for them to get in and out. And several people have approached me to see what I could do, knowing that I wasn't still on the board. So I thought I would come today and share those thoughts, because a lot of times things are not resolved because people are not made aware. And this is not a slight on the principal. This is not a slight on those who are a part of the traffic. Thank you for hearing me today.
Thank you, Keith. Mm-hmm. Thank you for bringing that to us. I notice our facilities people and operations people are taking copious notes, and I know they will look into that promptly. So thank you for bringing it to our attention. Also notice that, and board member Diane Bellamy Small had to leave the meeting for a period of time. She has another commitment for about 45 minutes, which leaves us without a quorum. So at this time, we're going to convert to a work session where we will not be taking any action. We'll be listening to the speakers from the floor and move forward, but we will not be taking any action in terms of as a board until she's able to return and we can return to having a quorum. So our next speaker is Cornelia Johnson, to be followed by Melissa Fisher. Ms. Johnson here? Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening. Thank you. My name is Melissa Fisher. I reside at 2 Long Cove Court, Greensboro, North Carolina. I want to address you all. I do have a child that's at Jamestown Middle School, and I'm here to discuss just a few topics that are redundant, being repeated over and over again, yet I think you are listening, but you're not hearing. Regarding the public information requests and charging parents, I can tell you this year alone, it appears that no one seems to know what is public information. Everyone gets to send, everything gets sent to district when it doesn't need to be. However, you want to charge parents. So who is trained when it comes to a public information request? Educate the administrators and staff, along with the Board of Education, who needs to be training as well, and not from the school attorney. Inconsistencies across the board. The Board of Education to district, to support, to administration. How can my child get a sound and basic education when no one has a clue as to what's going on? Also, stop comparing Guilford County schools to what is going on in Wake and Mecklenburg counties. And please stop saying we are making growth and progress, because we're not. According to the state report card for last year, only 48.3% of high school students who took the SAT were ready to get into a North Carolina university. This is growth, more like a disgrace. So you all need to focus on students and stop bickering with each other in closed meetings behind session. So unprofessional, but probably why Guilford County Schools is the way it is, because we haven't had a district-wide curriculum since Common Core was introduced. Not only that, and the reason that the Board of Education can't sort anything out. Also, this bullying thing that's going on. All schools, JMS one of them, is a PBIS school, and before the first 21 days of suspension, I can't tell you how many fights there were. So with that being said, I was told to keep your hands and feet to yourself, and this is the way it is handled. These are children in middle school, and I believe they need to take a more in-depth approach, because I'm losing my child. So my question to the Board of Education is this. Where is the Board of? Because education is not in it. So let the superintendent do her job. She's only been here a year, and give her the memorandum of understanding that she needs to learn to be able to do her job. And this right here with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 chairs missing is unacceptable. This is a public forum. It's been on the agenda, and we don't have all the school board, all the little BOE people here. Why is that? I wonder. Did they know that we had the little press conference outside, so, oh, they're scared to come today? This is about education for children. That's what this is for. So if the board can't get it together, then nobody else can get it together. So.
Thank you. Our next, if you would leave those with, if you have a handout, if you please leave them with Nicole, she will get them to us, please. Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Sarah Sills, to be followed by McElroy Hughes. Is Ms. Sills here? Yes, thank you. And I would note, if you agree with something, please indicate like this, so we can, because we do want to hear what the speaker says. And thank you for showing your agreement. That's helpful. Good evening and welcome.
My name is Sarah Sills. I use she, her pronouns. I live at 6895 Sunrise Drive, and I am a member of the anti-racist white folks serving Black Lives Matter Gate City, and I have a bone to pick with y'all. Last academic year, when High School Ahead Academy closed, the school district claimed that it would save 1.2 million funds, which would be used for a program to help 6th through 12th graders recover credits. Fast forward to tonight, when you all are about to approve a contract expansion to the tune of $800,000 with Apex Learning Virtual School. The expansion does not focus on recouping the loss experienced by the middle schoolers who lost their support last year. Instead, it offers a wide variety of courses up to honors, AP, and college level courses. It is my opinion that while this program may benefit those middle schoolers slightly, there will also be students using this program to earn credits early, get ahead, and get college credits for free. While there is no problem with that per se, It once again leaves behind students who are currently in need of extra help and assists those that are already performing adequately. This program will most benefit those who have consistent and reliable access to internet, which disadvantages students who are experiencing homelessness, students with families who are unable to afford internet, and students who have limited access to transportation. So long story short, you took funds from students far behind and you're allocating those unwisely. And speaking of unwise, please allow me to question your use of the consent agenda. It is my understanding that a consent agenda is for the purpose of expediting items that are non-controversial, routine, those which require no action, and those which require no discussion. I'm extremely confused as to how this issue ended up on the consent agenda, as I believe it requires extensive discussion, up to and including a larger discussion regarding the demographics of children who have fallen behind and why children of color are disproportionately affected by educational disparities. The Apex Learning Contract is a big ticket item spending nearly $1 million that will continue the cycle of underperforming students being pushed out even further. This is not a consent agenda item. It is my opinion that this was a sneaky move by the board and it has tarnished my trust for you even more. Before I leave you this evening, I'd like to echo concerns and complaints of my fellow parents who are appalled at the swift action taken by the board regarding the date of graduation. I checked your job description as prescribed by the bylaws, and there's nothing in there about being social coordinators and personal event planners for your constituents. This information makes your quick response to the graduation problem somewhat remarkable. I would love to know what about those particular parents made you suddenly move with such expediency. Is it because they presented a problem so much more pressing than others? Is it because their arguments were so much more convincing than others? Or is it because they have some sort of special privilege, some sort of, I don't know, unspoken, systematically perpetuated privilege that grants them more clout than others without their privileges? Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is McElroy Hughes, to be followed by Linda Shalito, and I hope that's right. I apologize if it's not. Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is McElroy Hughes, 1702 Alice Avenue. Not yet. Okay. You know, I was asked earlier tonight. I haven't seen you in a while. And part of that was because I let time do time, take care of time. And we seem to have had a lot of problems over the years. And they still see the same. Appreciate that young lady. This is ridiculous. And I mean everybody, and I'm not excluding race, creed, or color. This is ridiculous. And the same way it's ridiculous because nobody respects it, because if I let a meeting, you're going to follow me. Because if I can do it, you got to do it. So this is ridiculous. It reflects just how y'all do. So I let things go because I wanted to give this young lady, Sharon Contreras, time. I met with you earlier, Alan. I didn't want her up there. I wanted her because she works for the people. So I said, I'll let it go because her situation. I went to your office and you know I said it. And so I gave time, and y'all whined and dined her at the Civil Rights, Carolina Theater, gave her the best shrimp. We're my selected official. But we ain't shrimp that good night. We ain't good. You whined and dined her, setting up something, setting up it. This is how we do it, the diocese do it. This is how the Board of Ed, because you didn't introduce us to the people until after 6 months. Now she's 6 months in with a year, she ain't been with us because you whined and dined her and set precedents how you wanted to act, but it didn't work. She's from Upper City, aggressive. We are your yets for what's coming because she's up in that city and know what didn't, and there's a yet coming. You build up Greensboro, Mahaney, it's all connected. Mahaney and all of y'all, same people of non-color whites. You're building it up, but what are you building up for my kids? Nice Leo Club, young lady, but where's Kuma Jacqueline? Where's Armani Club, huh? Where's the Ben Jackhannon Club? Where's a black club to empower my kids? They don't feel that. And I asked you, you give us the less teachers, because with me and you, Constitution Allen, every principal and every high standard teacher went to Northwest. The lower conducted teachers went to Harrison, Washington, and you know they did. So you gave her a transition team. I said, Sharon, she gave me a meeting, I appreciate that. You ain't got a me in the room. I'm in a low performing school, Title I ambassadors, I'm the oldest DPAC ambassador there is. Why wasn't I there? If you ain't got a me in the room, a radical, straightforward, you ain't got nobody in that room. Because this is what makes the word diversity so important. You tell Darlene and Anita, I was with her in a meeting at Grimsley. They're getting bigger. Who, Billy Bob? That's your kids. Oh, Ramel and Rashawn getting bigger. What you mean they're getting, that's what she said. We need them. Those kids, they're getting bigger. Who? Ain't none of my kids been getting bigger because I whip them. Okay, how big they get. So what was her message? Darlene Garrett has voted. I was letting her speak nice to me every time. But she has not yet voted for a black person coming in superintendent without voting against them. We're not. I told you last time I was here, don't bother that young lady. It's going to be hell to catch up. It's going to be more than that. Because black men are not home. And if we can get some hope off this young lady, let it be. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Linda Shalito. And please correct me if I've mispronounced your name. I apologize. Shalito. Followed by, I believe, T. Williams. Good evening and welcome.
Hi, I'm Linda Shalito. I live at 2514 Timber Lane. I'm a member of the Anti-Racist White Folks Serving Black Lives Matter Gate City and a Guilford County parent. I'm speaking today to express my support for our superintendent. I was first made aware of Dr. Contreras when she sent an email to parents stating her and the district's dedication to the inclusiveness and safety of all students and families, regardless of nationality, immigration status, race, gender, sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, religion, creed, political belief, socioeconomic status, or any other characteristic that made them who they are. That email made me proud to be a Guilford County School parent. Dr. Contreras is committed to all of our students and all of their success. She does not work only within the confines of the school system, but reaches out to the community at large because the school system does not function in a vacuum. She has shaken things up in her short time here, and I'm excited to see the fruit that her hard work and dedication will bear. However, I have to say that I did not see this dedication to inclusiveness reflected by the board earlier this month. I also did not see the support of Dr. Contreras that sometimes I hear at these board meetings. That support seems to be used more as a bargaining chip to be doled out or withheld depending upon how the board member feels about the issue at hand. I find it incredibly telling that this board will unquestionably support Dr. Contreras when she is recommending a new security approach in schools, but will take it upon themselves to overrule her decision in changing graduation dates after what must have been an exhaustive and thoughtful approach to the logistics of the situation. You passed a $1.2 million contract for security cameras when the finance representative wasn't even able to tell you the cost of repairing damages due to vandalism. But you very nearly failed to pass a reading program that was recommended after extensive research, a complete presentation of those findings, and exhaustive questioning of the staff. I find it telling that part of the research showed a major reading disparity among children of color as opposed to their white counterparts. I find it very telling that there was not an immediate concern resulting in action. I find it very telling that when five white women representing the three whitest high schools in the district came to complain about graduation dates affecting their child's vacation schedule, action was immediately taken. I understand that you're beholden to your constituents. However, are you not also beholden to the school district at large? Are complaints over scheduling for a handful of students, presumably without major socioeconomic disadvantages, more important than the needs of all students? You are responsible for ensuring quality education and safety, not for aligning vacation schedules.
Thank you. Our next speaker is T. Williams, to be followed by Megan, I believe it's Tarver. Dean, is that you?
Yes, I've been on for the last three speakers.
Okay, thank you. Please note that Dina has joined the meeting.
Good afternoon.
Welcome, good evening.
My name is Terrell Williams, and I reside at 6592 Bob White Lane, Brown Summit. my question for the board today is more guided towards the status of the middle colleges, the early colleges. Primarily the North Carolina A&T Middle College. I'm sorry, the North Carolina A&T Middle College. I think the college was initially came about around 2003, and it served, it was a opportunity for children, students that may not be succeeding or needed a change in environment from the norm. It also made it they made the environment more adaptable for kids to succeed. North Carolina A&T Middle College is a all-boys school, and around 2006, the mission changed. The mission changed to where They were focusing on college credits, getting kids college prepared. And over the next few years, they were producing 100% graduation rates. They were having 100% college acceptance rates. And these kids were getting ready, getting prepared, and being successful as they transitioned from high school into college curriculums. And my question or concern is that, is there a change with that focus for the middle colleges, or all of them, or A&T? Is there a change where we're looking at going back to 2003 and making the school more of a graduation environment, just, you know, getting kids out and not necessarily focusing on making them college prepared? In 2010, they had a 96% graduation rate. 2011, they had a 100% college acceptance. 2011, they was a school of distinction. 2011, they won the Turnaround Performance Award. 2012, they had 100% graduation rate. And these are a little old, but 14, 15, those were similar numbers for the kids come out of there then. So as a parent of two children, one who's currently a sophomore engineering student at North Carolina A&T who went through the program, and I think that had a lot to do with his success at A&T now, and a parent of another child that's currently there, I would just hope that the board would inform the parents if there's going to be a transition or a backing away of that college preparedness or that attempt to make these kids ready for the next level of education. Okay. Thank you.
Speaker is Megan Tarver, to be followed by Sandra Isley. Good evening. Welcome.
Hello. My name is Megan Tarver. I reside at 5102 Mountain Ash Court. I'm here as a member of the anti-racist white folks serving Black Lives Matter. I'm here in support of the superintendent. This is the Guilford County Schools A History book. It was published in 1991. Despite references to educating Black students dating back to 1868, there is not one picture of a Black person in this entire book. In fact, there's no pictures of anyone who's not white. This is important. The first time I saw this book, it was on the shelves of a predominantly Black elementary school. While it is doubtful that the elementary school students were reading the book for its contents, how must it feel to look at a book on the history of the schools in your county and see no one that looks like you? In general, references to Black students were relegated to the desegregation chapter, conveniently cordoned off like a Black History Month curriculum. References outside of that chapter were primarily negative in nature and almost always in comparison to the preferential treatment of whites. Fast forward to the present, where Black voices continue to be minimized and silenced. While I was unable to attend the last meeting, I did get some feedback from community members who were there. I watched the public comments on the recorded video regarding the graduation date change. What I saw was five white women from three primarily white schools who came to the board to tell Dr. Contreras how to do her job. In fact, some of them acknowledged that setting the graduation dates was usually the superintendent's job. And state laws, Muslim holidays, and a careful consideration to rotate the schedule and lessen the number of graduations per day apparently didn't matter. They believed they knew better. I saw seven people, primarily people of color, speak favorably about the date change, one specifically pointing out that Smith High School finally had a favorable slot. Attending board meetings for the last couple of months, I've seen Black people come before this board advocating on behalf of their students. They seem to be met with feedback about state laws and policies that cannot be changed and facility studies that need to be conducted. I've seen the same people having to come to multiple meetings to speak on the same issue. I've seen no sense of urgency at these meetings to address the concerns of these parents, but let a handful of white parents mention that the graduation schedule is messing with their vacation plans and there's an immediate reaction that something must be done. During the board discussion, there was much passion directed toward doing something for the constituents, but all people who speak before the board are constituents. It is clear that this board values certain voices over others. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Sandra Isley, to be followed by Nina Joy Frazier.
Hi, my name is Sandra Isley. I reside at 1009 Bellevue Street. and I have a daughter that goes to Irwin Montessori. And I'm here to speak on the support of Dr. Contreras. I was appalled when I read the email, but I wasn't shocked because as an educated black woman, I have faced also the same destructive pit that she's facing with you all trying to get her off the board for knowing her job. It's unfair that we have to dumb ourselves down. And I'm strong in the education system for my child because I refuse to let it happen to another generation. I support Dr. Contreras because my children need books with brown bodies and brown faces in it. And if she can get them to them, all the more better. Greensboro need a good shaking up and waking up, and Contreras just happened to be the first one to do it. And I'm going to support her and anybody else that comes before this city and tell them what their issues are and make you all face them. Because we do have a serious issue in this city based on disparity. People want to talk about what it is wrong with us. What's wrong with us is that we don't have people listening to us, to us telling you all what's wrong, and everybody else trying to tell us what's wrong with us. You don't know our walk. You don't know what we've been through. You cannot tell us. And I feel like when we come up here, it's just for form, for show, and you're not listening. It's good to have a superintendent that is listening. We reason why we have to bury our children instead of it being the other way around is because they're being educated more in the streets than they are in a school building. We're on our 33rd homicide this year. People want to say it's because we're having children out of wedlock. Having a child out of wedlock has nothing to do with a lack of resources. We need resources in our community for our children to learn and to be able to leave school and go somewhere productive and grow into a productive human being. We don't have that. They leave the school system, they come home, they watch their mothers gripe and complain because we don't make a living wage. Then you want to charge us for paper that we already paid for because they sending us lists that the school needs, the teacher needs, that we have to pull out of our almost empty pockets and pay for. So how are we going to pay for copies when we already paying for the paper that you're copying it on? Let's get real about what's going on in Greensboro. Well, our children, I had to spend the first part of the school year running people down to get snacks into our school. We got real issues besides a graduation date. We need to make sure that our children are getting to graduation first. We're not concentrating on the real issues. And I support Dr. Contreras, and I hope she continue to go against the grain and do what's needed on our Board of Education and in the city of Greensboro.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Nina Joy Frazier, to be followed by Ed Curry. Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening. I'm actually not scheduled to speak until the next meeting, but since you called me up, I wanted to just say that I come to support Dr. Contreras 150%, and everything that the young lady said before me is absolutely true. I will be doing some further research on the school board and your activities in Greensboro, and I will be back at the next meeting to address you fully once I'm informed. But from what I see, you are doing a wonderful job. We appreciate you. We do need multicultural education and diversities in our schools, and we also need someone who is listening to the people. So please continue to do what you do in the way that you do it. We support you if no one else does. So thank you, and I will be back.
Yes. Thank you. We'll look forward to seeing you next time. Our next speaker is Ed Curry, to be followed by Joe Stafford. Good evening and welcome.
Good evening. I'm Ed Curry from Jamestown, North Carolina, and I'm a sub for Southwest High School. And I do a lot of my subbing at Southwest and Southwest Middle. In fact, I was named the Volunteer of the Year for Southwest High School, and I'm very proud of that. I have painted classrooms, got paint donated, painted the band room, helped with the junior-senior prom, fishing club, and now the president of DECA, Booster Club at Southwest High. These are just a few of the things that I'm very, very proud of. But I come tonight with a simple request and a question of why. A substitute is paid once a month. Yep, we are only paid once a month. And I don't understand why our pay cannot be like the teacher pay. For example, all the days that I sub during the month of September, well, I will not get a check for that until November 1st. What happened to October 1st? What happened to October the 15th? With all the new banking technology, it could be keyed into the computers and it could be given to us by the end of the month. Are our treasurers not doing their jobs? We could get better. Our new system at Southwest is now computerized. They take my picture, they put a badge on me, and it's all computerized. Could that not be hooked up to the payroll system? Each of the subs that work around me, they all understand and they say, why are we not getting paid on time? It's really bad. I've been told by a very, very bunch of subs that work with me, they would like to be paid and like to have their money given to them faster. It would also help to have some better subs, because some of the subs that work for us have decided to quit because they don't get paid on time. Putting our name out could be easier and we could get more subs if we could get a better pay rate, a better pay scale. Yes, I guess the next thing that I'm going to talk to you about is a pay raise. You know that we are going to be next on, when is it going to be next for us to get a raise? Again, teachers are out for some reason, and all they have to do is call it ASOP, and they get a sub. Well, we could get great subs, and we could get other fine teachers dedicated to the job if we were paid better. Is this something you can think about? Next, and I swear this is the last request that I'm going to go into, payroll. Getting a pay stub is just about virtually impossible. I don't understand why it can't be at the end of the month. We get a stub just like anything else, and it could be emailed to us. We have to go into the computer, and we have to go do this, and we have to do that. And I think that's one of the other things that we need to do. Now, I hope you think about all these things, because I'll be running for Guilford County Board of Education next time. Hope my smiling face is on that side and not looking at you now, because I will be running for Guilford County Board of Education. Keep my seat warm or move over. And thank you for all you do as great
thank
Board
you.
Of Education.
Thank you. Let me ask if, Angie, if you could have someone contact Mr. Curry to try to respond to some of the questions that were asked, please. The next speaker is Joe Stafford, to be followed by Dr. Goldie Wells.
Joe Stafford, 4604 Forest Village Drive, Greensburg. I have discussed it once before, but it didn't get much attention. I believe that every person hired by our Board of Education should be paid a living wage. We know what a living wage is now. An extensive study has been done by the Massachusetts Institute of Technology on how much money does it take to just live. And they came up with a figure of a few cents below $15 an hour. $15 an hour is not a lot. Some of us pay a babysitter more than that. And you read in the paper where Target and these others going $15 an hour. But we expect our employees are not just anybody. We expect them to be there. We give them 9 months instead of 12. But when you go to the grocery store, you got to pay. You can't say, well, I'm on 9 months. We've got several people, dozens, maybe 100 or 200, I don't know. They're making less than $15 an hour. And it's a disgrace. Needs to be changed immediately. And the problem is that people come up here and talk about this. What we are upset about is that you can't ever get anything on the agenda. You get up, you hear us, but you don't let us have a chance to make the case for some of the most important things in the world. $15 an hour if you can't live on it. Well, how do they live on it? Well, they live on it, one, hopefully they have a spouse that makes a bunch of money or something, or maybe they use their own money. Maybe they that, but any way you go, $15 an hour minimum. And I don't understand, just because we've given these people raises of 1%, 2% for the last 10 years, it don't make up for it. The fact is they can't make enough to have a decent living. This doesn't matter whether you're white or black or whatever. The amount of money to do a decent living is to have shelter over your head, is to have food, a little transportation. What I think so bad about it is we've sold education to our employees that don't earn. They have dreams for their kids. They'd like to send their kid to college. They've and all that. But can you imagine trying to send your kid to college at $15 or less an hour? I would ask the chairman to put it on the agenda and to immediately take action to raise these people to that level. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Goldie Wells, to be followed by Leah Swan, who recognize you as a fellow elected official. Thank you for being here.
Good evening to the board members that are present. I'm here my name is Goldie Wells. I live at 4203 Belfield Drive, Greensboro, North Carolina. I'm here as a council member tonight to read a resolution that the city of Greensboro did for Dr. Melvin Swan. City of Greensboro City Council resolution declaring Saturday, August 19th, 2017, Dr. Melvin C. Mel Swan Jr. Day. Whereas Dr. Melvin C. Mel Swan Jr. served in the Guilford County school systems for 36 years, whereas he began his career in education as a health and science teacher in 1960, went on to become an assistant principal at J.C. Price Junior High School and became principal of Price in 1969, a position he held until 1971 when he was promoted to Director of Student Affairs. Whereas during his tenure with the Greensboro City School System, Dr. Swan served as Assistant Superintendent for Pupil Personnel Services, Assistant Superintendent for Professional Support Services, Assistant Superintendent for Elementary Schools and Community Services, and Associate Superintendent for Administration and Management. Whereas the school board selected Dr. Swan to serve as the first ever Deputy Superintendent of Guilford County Schools when the Greensboro, High Point, and Guilford County school systems merged in 1993. Whereas after serving for 36 years, Dr. Swan retired in July of 1997 and has been esteemed in the community for improving the quality of education in Guilford County. Whereas the Guilford County Board of Education voted to rename Acock Junior Middle School Swan Middle School in honor of Dr. Melvin C. Swan Jr. Whereas the renaming dedication ceremony take place on Saturday, August 19, 2017, and whereas the City Council is being asked to declare Saturday, August 19, 2017, as Dr. Melvin C. Swan Jr. Day in the City of Greensboro. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the City Council of the City of Greensboro that it hereby declares Saturday, August 19, 2017, as Dr. Melvin C. Swan Jr. Day. Adopted this 15th day of August 2017. And whereas I have a few more minutes.
Well, we turned off the timer, so don't get too excited. Okay, did not want to interrupt the resolution.
I see 229 up here.
Well, it's because we turned it off. If you read that in 31 seconds, but you can go ahead and make a couple more. Turn the timer back on to give her.
I would like to stand in support of Dr. Contreras. I have sat here and I was just appalled at the things that went on at the last board meeting, but I was so excited when I heard that Dr. Contreras was coming to Greensboro with all of the credentials that she had. I knew that our children were behind, and that's really the reason we have CASE, because we found out that children were so far behind that the gap was so large. Our African-American children need something different. So I was thinking with the leadership of Dr. Contreras, we would have a difference in our system. What I find is when she tries to make a difference, there is pushback because people don't seem to understand the education system and how it works. I'm a retired educator myself. I know some of the things that she proposes are absolutely necessary for the successful academic achievement of our children. So I'm here to support, and I know there are all of you who support Dr. Contreras, stand up. Just stand up and let the folks know. Everybody can't come to this microphone, but we've already talked in closed session, and we talked to you one by one, and now we're showing our support. And we will be here to support the superintendent. We're saying our superintendent because all of us are in Guilford County, and she is our superintendent, and we want to support her. We want the results to be different for our children, especially our African-American students.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Leah Swan, and she will be followed by our final speaker tonight, Lisa Harris. Good evening and welcome. It's nice to see you again.
Good evening. My name is Leah Swan, and my address is 8 Friends Meadow Drive. I'm just here on behalf of my grandmother, Gloria Jean Swan, and myself, and the rest of our family and friends. I would like to thank the board for renaming Charles B. Acock Middle School, now Dr. Melvin C. Swan Middle School. I just wanna thank you all for being there for the program. The program was beautiful. I wanna thank Ms. Keisha Brown and the staff at Swan Middle. They're awesome. I watched them work tirelessly in and out, day in and out, getting ready for that program. And I appreciate everything they do. I said I was gonna be a lunch buddy. I went this week. My fiance and I have a cousin, Ambie goes there. Oh, I'm sorry, she's a student there. And we had lunch and it was a beautiful thing. A lot of my friends are now gonna do it. And I just wanted to say that we collected almost $13,000. The community did, and we had donations and things. Some of that money went toward the caterer and the reception. It went toward the fans and the magnets that were there for the program. It also went toward the transportation for the families the day of the program. And last but not least, these flash drives, which I have for you all, each one of the board members, that are 8 gig flash drives. Every student at Swan Middle School and staff member has one of these. So these are for you all. This was the main focus because, as you all know, my grandfather was an educator and he put children first. So the kids just got their computers yesterday, so they got these too. Again, I want to thank you all from the bottom of my heart. You'll see more of me. It's not just over. This is something that every Swan, hopefully when I have children, they'll get to see this. And sometimes I just still pinch myself. I drive by because I know he's up there smiling down on this. And I thank you again, and this is for you all.
Thank you so much. Thank you both for the resolution and for your thanks. It was a wonderful occasion to be able to rename the school for your grandfather, who's a wonderful, wonderful man.
Thank you again.
Thank you. Our final speaker tonight is Lisa Harris. Sorry, Lisa, I apologize.
That's okay. Good evening. My address is Post Office Box 78174, Greensboro, North Carolina. Tonight, I'm not taken for words because we've got a community who's already mentioned each and every word. However, I do want to read to you something. The superintendent is authorized to establish necessary administrative procedures or rules, make all decisions, establish practices, and develop activities the superintendent deems appropriate to achieve. That's your own Board of Education policy. Yes, the next words say the board's goals and policies. I will let the board know that there will be a public information request asking what are the board's goals and policies. I knew by attending several of your committee meetings, I hear your board members asking for clarification as it relates to the public information laws. At this stage in life, I do want each of you to know that as parents and community, we have a right to public information. I also want to read to you, the North Carolina Public Records Law provides a broad right to access the records of the public agencies. Just want to let you know, for any board member that doesn't know, Gifford County Schools is a public agency. It's very disappointing to sit at a policy committee meeting and listen to board members say, inquire as it relates to the fees that it takes to get staff to pull public records information. Now, let me be very clear, because I don't want to be misunderstood and be quoted in the next policy committee meeting. I am not against the administrative regulations. The district needs a policy to tell staff what to do. My concern is for many families who cannot afford the fees. And if you go and look at the spreadsheet that I did do a public information request for, many of the requests are from parents asking for academic and educational, community members asking for agency information. While you may not know as new board members, previous administration advised people if you have any inquiries to send it to district relations. It's a lot of unclarity that you may not know as new board members. While each board member that I would like to address tonight is not here, I will like to address those of you who are, who decided to support on September the 7th the motion to change graduation date. While I was not at the microphone, I am a senior parent of a black female daughter, and the graduation date in the middle of the week does not matter to me. What matters to me is she and other black students and other students of color and other students in Gifford County are college and career ready. My message is always the same. Level fours and level fives on state assessments, ACT, SAT scores, all of that. So what I'm asking you tonight, for those of you who are here, is support the vision of the superintendent. While we are here, I'm asking everybody here, stand one last time and support the superintendent of this school district, Gifford County Schools. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you all for standing. All right, that concludes our public comments for tonight. And what I'd like to do is to ask the superintendent to provide her report at this time, which is a little out of the order we would normally go.
Thank you, Chairman Duncan, board members, and to the community. Thank you for being here this evening. Last week, we had the opportunity to recognize and say thank you to our educators and dedicated staff members during our annual Celebration of Excellence program. We also announced our 2017-2018 Principals and Teacher of the Year. Our Teacher of the Year is Shonda Hamm, a math teacher at the Middle College at GTCC Greensboro. Her students say she genuinely cares about them, and Shonda shared that she never wanted to be anything else but a teacher. Our Principal of the Year, John Carlos Miller, has helped improve each school that he's led. Under his direction, Weaver Academy was ranked the number one high school in North Carolina by the U.S. News and World Report. We will not soon forget his comments during his acceptance speech, where he shared a teacher told him he would never amount to anything. So he dedicated that award to the teacher who helped him become Principal of the Year. Yesterday, I spoke on schools and the economy. What's the real return on investment as part of Guilford Education Alliance's speaker series? Imagine what our community could be if we had the resources, flexibility, and most importantly, the will to truly carry out what is good for our students and our community. The speech will be posted on the GEA website. Earlier today, I spoke at a Minority Women Enterprise Development Luncheon. My remarks centered on the importance of developing people of color and women in underrepresented fields, something I know a little bit about. Southern Middle was recognized at the luncheon for their inclusion of MWBE firms at the career fair. And we're very proud of the work they are doing to introduce students, particularly students of color, to fields that they ordinarily would not be exposed to. I'm happy to report that the district has won a Professional Development for Arts Educators grant in the amount of $1,420,000 to fund an Arts Integration Academy. The Guilford County Schools Arts Integration Academy represents a partnership between us, UNCG, and a community of artists, galleries, theaters, and museums. This project will impact 18 schools, 90 teachers, and more than 10,000 students, and approximately 150 community partners. Congratulations to the grant writing team and the Director of Arts, Mr. Nathan Street, for all of your efforts in helping us attain this grant for the Guilford County Schools. Guilford County Schools will offer free dental care for students next week, October 2nd through 4th. Christina Smile, a nonprofit mobile dental care facility in cooperation with the PGA Tour and Champions Tour, provides free dental care to children in need ages 6 to 15. Many children experience chronic dental pain or serious dental disease and deterioration for months or years before gaining access to a clinic. Students lacking dental care for the past 2 years and families who lack dental insurance are eligible to participate. Transportation to and from the schools will be provided. If you have children who are in need of dental care, please call the Guilford County Schools English Learners Department at 336-370-8982. Services will be located at Volvo, 7900 National Service Road in Greensboro. Learning doesn't stop on Fridays and doesn't just apply to our students. Approximately 200 teachers of AP and IB courses attended the Fall AB-IB Saturday this past Saturday at Page High School. Teachers had the opportunity to explore data to identify areas of instructional focus, to focus on how to increase equity and opportunity of access for all students, and to engage in collaboration and learning for students in college-level courses. Thank you to all of the teachers who attended. I want to thank all of the parents who made certain to have their children vaccinated before the 20th day of school. The deadline to submit proof of vaccinations was Tuesday. As of today, we have a 98.5% compliance rate with 86 students who were excluded from school. I want to thank our students and school nurses for doing a great job getting the word out, and I want to ensure the parents of those 86 students, we will do everything in our power to help you with acquiring the necessary vaccinations. We are continuing our Change for Children campaign, and it's off to a great start. If every school raised just $160, we would be able to send more than $20,000 to the Houston and Dallas school districts. A huge thank you to all of the schools and staff members that are participating in the campaign. We will announce our grand total on October 16th, and we will also expand that to our fellow citizens in Puerto Rico. Tomorrow evening, our Jewish brothers and sisters will begin their observance of Yom Kippur. Yom Kippur, which means Day of Atonement, is the most important holiday of the Jewish year. At this time, our Jewish brothers and sisters will refrain from eating or drinking, even water, for 25 hours. I take this time to wish them a happy new year and an easy fast. And finally, I'd like to remind you that October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Breast cancer is by far the most common cancer in women worldwide, claiming 458,000 lives each year, according to the World Health Organization. Let us take a moment to remember those whom we have lost and those who fight the disease valiantly. Thank you so much. That concludes my comments.
Thank you very much. At this time, we're at approval of the agenda, and I'm going to ask that it be approved as is, but would like to pull item C, the Apex Learning Virtual School, from the consent agenda to be the first item on a staff report. Do we have a second to that motion?
I second the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. All in favor of the agenda, please raise your hand, and then I'll ask for Dina's vote. All right.
We were asked to address that tonight.
I understand that. We can talk about that. Let me get the vote on this. Dina, how do you vote on the agenda?
Yes.
Thank you, Dina. All right, so then let's start with the consent agenda. Sharon, turn to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. This evening, the consent agenda includes several items. Those items include the personnel report and the 2017-18 budget amendments transfers report.
All right, any questions or comments on that? All right, all in favor? I don't think we have to go separately in this time. All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed, raise your hand. Dina, how do you vote on that?
Yeah, I vote yes.
All right. I don't have a vote from Byron on this yet, the consent agenda. Voted no, I'm sorry. Oh, no. I didn't see. I apologize. So passes by a vote of 3-2. That then brings us to our Apex Learning Virtual School item.
Dr. Oakley. Are you placing the PowerPoint up? As an introduction, please know the Apex Learning Virtual School is a recommendation from the superintendent. As you know, when we close high school ahead, that school only served approximately 100 students, and I promised that we would find a way to help students who were behind in terms of credits make up or recover lost credits. This initiative will help more than 1,000 students, where previously High School Ahead could only serve 100 middle school students. We're now able to help more than 1,000 middle school and high school students recover credits. Unlike other virtual programs that we have used in the past, this particular program uses live teachers. Students will have access to live teachers and tutors to support them. We have also pulled the data indicating or demonstrating which students have participated in credit recovery in the past. Certainly, there's work to be done as the students who need the credit recovery the most have not been directed to participate in those programs. But because we now have the data, the school support officers are working with the school counselors to make sure that the students who need to recover credits the most are participating in credit recovery activities. So with that, I will open the floor to board members and allow them to ask staff questions about the contract.
Thank you. Are there any questions or comments on this contract? Yes, Wes.
I'm
understanding that this replaces the Odyssey contract, is that correct? Mm-hmm. I see the price tag on the Apex contract. You know the value of the Odyssey contract before it was terminated?
The Odyssey contract was $27,414. That was a cost that is no longer existent. The service is no longer there. So because it was bought out, probably because of the datedness of both the product and the price tag is probably why they were acquired, is our speculation, hence the difference.
But it did not offer the same services.
Mm-mm. And that was my next question.
Correct.
If you could describe the difference between an $800,000 service and a $23,000 service.
Mm-hmm. You want to speak to that?
So with the Odyssey being $22,000, that was a credit recovery provider. That was not the going rate for any provider that currently provides services for districts. That was a grandfathered in price that was recurring each year for us. So we were able to receive that cost under a grandfathered price. When we put out an RFP, after they were purchased, bought out, the RFP came back, and all of the new providers who responded to that were in the consistent price range of what we're looking at with the Apex option.
But I think in terms of the difference of service, which is what you're talking about, previously in the Odyssey credit recovery piece, students did not have access to live teacher support. They did not have access to features that included them to have the text on the screen read aloud. Also, the level of rigor that happened within the Odyssey content was that students could click through. They could click through a quiz as many times as it took to pass, and so they could actually recover their credit in theory without mastering the content. So having the live teacher support, having the parameters to be able to ensure student mastery, and having the level of rigor so that students who are recovering credits are also college and career ready is something we owe them, and something that the committee that looked at the RFPs felt was important.
There was some concern from one of the public comment speakers that these opportunities were not extended down to the middle school level, for instance, the high school ahead folks. Is that correct? Can they be involved in this also?
Yeah, that is inaccurate. Apex Learning provides middle school content for math, English language arts, and their development science, history, and other content area courses. Right now, they actually have what's called tutorials for middle school students, and that allows students to get accelerated learning to catch up. So for the high school ahead students, they are able to, let's say, catch up on content that they missed from 6th to 8th grade. That solution is provided so that those students are able to do that. So that is built in. So the statement previously was inaccurate. It has a pretty well-developed course content for middle school students, but it expands beyond the middle school students, and it also goes into the high school area, allowing for additional access and course options for high school students.
Can you discuss the source of the funding for this program, given the wide disparity of the old contract versus the new contract? When did we become aware that the Odyssey program was going to close?
That became in the spring.
Okay.
So once the spring and we got that announcement, that's when we developed our RFP team and began the process.
Understand.
Angie, funding question.
Sure. So when we closed high school ahead, the savings, $800,000 of those savings we have directed to this be used for this purpose. Those dollars are recurring, so they will continue to be in our budget unless until redirected by the board in the future.
When you say reoccurring, you're anticipating the money saved on high school ahead to?
It will, yeah. There's unless it's redirected elsewhere, those dollars have been identified and budgeted for this purpose.
For multiple years in the future then? Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, we do the budget every year, so
right.
It's at any point that could be redirected, but our intent is at this point to continue funding this.
Just as one other clarifying point, the board already approved the budget for this.
Exactly.
You're actually voting on the specific contract. But during the budget season, you voted for, I believe, up to $1 million for credit recovery.
That's right.
$100,000.
All right, any other questions? Wes, does that answer yours?
Thank you.
Very good.
Thank
Anyone
you.
Else?
I just
said a follow-up question from the public comments that stated that it was put on the consent agenda and this particular item. And is the rationale for that because when five of us voted for the budget, that we voted knowing that we would fund this project, so it didn't really, I mean, it was understood that there wouldn't have been a whole lot of input. Is that the rationale? Did I understand it?
Yes.
Okay. That's all.
All right. Dina, do you have comments or questions?
No, I don't.
All right, thank you. Are we ready to vote? We need a motion, I suppose, to approve the recommendation for approval of the Apex Learning Virtual School contract not to exceed $800,000. Anyone care to move for that?
I'll make a motion.
Thank you, Pat.
Second.
Thank you, Byron. All right, everybody, if you could go ahead and cast your votes, please. And Dean, I'll be with you in 1 second.
Okay.
Okay, Dina.
Yes.
Thank you. And it passes by vote of, do you have Dina's? Can you?
Her lights went out.
All right.
Okay. There we go.
Okay, very good. Passed by a vote of 5-0. It passes unanimously. Thank you for clarifying any questions. I think that's very helpful to everybody, so thank you for that. That now then brings us to the construction update as our second staff report item. Thank you all for your help. Appreciate it. Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Welcome. Chair and Superintendent, members of the board. It's a pleasure to be here this evening to report on our monthly construction. We're pleased to report that this is getting shorter each and every month as we complete projects. Yes. And are looking forward to continued ribbon cutting ceremonies. I know a lot of us were at one yesterday at Hunter Elementary. We do have the report here with you this evening. And just a reminder that the MWBE report is a repeat from last month. That will be updated, I believe, in October when the new quarter begins, as well as the change order report. So at this point in time, I would turn it over to Mr. Julius Monk, who can walk through the detail of the report.
Good evening, everyone. As Mr. McCulley said, at Hunter, we had a ribbon cutting yesterday, and we'd like to thank members of the board that were there. The students did an excellent job. There was a wrap at the end. They showed us the beam that they all signed that is prominent there in the media center, and I think that everyone was happy with the way that the school turned out and that it looked. At High Point Central, the stair tower addition, the tower shaft is at full height there, and we'll be soon setting steel to put the roof on that. The brick veneer is on site, and the exterior insulation and waterproofing is nearing completion. With the fire sprinkler installation, the construction documents are due the end of this month of September, and we will begin the design review of that next week with different departments, and we hope to put that out to bid towards the end of October, first part of November. At Western High School, the physical education improvements there, that project is substantially complete, and the contractor is working on the punch list items. The ribbon cutting ceremony for that project is scheduled for October 28th at 4 p.m. And Western Gifford Middle School replacement, installation of the brick veneer there is complete. Installation of interior metal stud walls continue. The bus parking lot has been paved, finished painting has begun, and the permanent water has been connected to the building. And with that, I'll open it up for questions.
Wes.
Folks, thank you. I had the opportunity to attend the Hunter Elementary ribbon cutting, and it was a fine piece of construction. I think that the staff was extremely pleased with their new facility, and it just looked marvelous. And through the efforts of both the contractor and the GCS construction staff, I think it turned out very well. I would have to contradict you just on one point, Scott. I'm disappointed this list is not growing with new construction projects.
Absolutely.
Okay. So hopefully we'll...
We concur.
We'll turn that around in the near future so that we can have more schools like Hunter Elementary to serve our students. But thank you for the efforts on all the projects that are coming to completion, and hopefully they'll turn out very well. I know that Smith High School is very excited about having its homecoming activities on its new field with its new field house. So wish them very well tomorrow night.
Thank you.
Other questions, comments? Dr. Byron.
Thank you all. It is coming down to a close. Is there an update about with Smith specifically about the issue with the window and door thing that we had talked about, Mr. McCullough?
Yes, in the press box area in the coach's office, we did remove the countertop, and from all accounts, everyone is pleased with their access to the window now. So,
yeah. All right, thank you. And I see our MWBE participation for these projects are higher than our district, recommendation, and I'm grateful for that. After attending the MWBE luncheon today, we definitely have more work to do, and we wouldn't have MWBE if we had equity in terms of bidding and contractors, and the fact that, non-MWBE contractors have the resources to put in those bids, can lowball every other contractor in town because they have existing resources and capital and can, just wait out the competition. And so I definitely felt empowered today to continue that, and I thank you all for I see those numbers are going up higher and higher every project that we've done. Even with our subcontract, those numbers are going up, and our MBE as well as WBE is increasing. So thank you for that. And thank you for the work you've done with Smith and all of the other projects. Thank you.
Thank you. Dean, do you have anything? I want to check with you.
No, Byron, summed it up for me. Thank you.
What? Thank you. all right, so... there's nothing to vote on, so our thanks for the continued good work. I sort of agree with Wes's comment. Let's hope that we can move to some other needs, because I know you're spending a lot of time on identifying the needs and prioritizing them along with the work that's going to be done on that. So by the outside consultant as we move forward with that process. But I hope we are enabled to get to do some more of that. We certainly need it. So I agree with Wes. All right, that brings us to our Tableau data dashboard.
Thank you. Over and over since I've come to Guilford County, the community has shared with me their deep concern about the lack of transparency around data. This is the district's initiative that we are rolling out to increase transparency around performance in our schools and information in our schools by the rollout of a data dashboard that the community would have access to, 24/7 access to. So with that, I will introduce Dr. Penny. And again, you have Scott McCulley here. And if you'd introduce your guests, please, then.
Sure, thank you. So our guest here in the middle is Michael LeClaire, who is our new Director of Data Analytics and Support for the school system. And it is his department. And Sharon McLeese, who could not be here, she is not feeling well.
Can't hear you.
I'm sorry. Sharon McLeese may be here in a few minutes. She's not been feeling well, but her department is also working with us on the development of the data dashboard. So it's a very collaborative
Stop program. And welcome, Michael.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening. Glad you're here.
Okay, just to talk a minute about what data dashboards are and how they're used they're used throughout businesses, but also through public education. They are visual displays that organize and present information that makes it easy for people to read the information, to interpret it, and to kind of understand it. They're web-based, and most data dashboards are also interactive, so you can explore things within the dashboards. You do that by having filters. You can filter on a variety of things. You can sort. You can drill down into the information. So we have selected Tableau for a variety of reasons. One is we want a dashboard that's transparent, and Tableau is very intuitive and easy to use, so it will be easy for both our principals who will use the internal dashboard and for our community who will use our public dashboards. We wanted something that would provide some parent and community engagement, and again, Tableau is very intuitive and easy for people to use and navigate. Tableau allows us to have multiple data sources that we can import into our dashboards. There's been a lot of customer satisfaction with people that have used Tableau, and it allows multiple deployment options. So we can have a public dashboard, and we can also have an internal dashboard that allows our staff to drill down to the student level data. These are just a sample of some of the school districts. There are many, many districts throughout the country that are using Tableau. Wake County in North Carolina is using Tableau, and Winston-Salem Forsyth County has just moved to having a data dashboard this year using Tableau. Atlanta, Georgia, whom we visited and talked with, Denver, Colorado, Oakland, we're going to show you some of the Oakland dashboard tonight, Minneapolis, Houston, there are just many districts, that large and small, that are using Tableau or other data dashboards. As I said before, this has been an interdepartmental collaboration. Accountability and Research has been working with student information on the development of the dashboards. Sharon McLeese and I visited Atlanta, Georgia, and some of the lessons that we learned when we went to Atlanta is to take our time in the development of the dashboards. We need to be very careful in terms of all the data that we pull together to make sure we have the right data and to make sure we have all the data that consumers are going to want, because consumers will want to drill down. We need to make sure we have all the options for drilling down into the data. So they have suggested that we take our time in the development of the dashboards, and we are planning to do that. So we will roll out dashboards, not all at once, but roll them out over time. And we also have been working with a principal dashboard group that's been giving us advice about what they would like to see in terms of the internal dashboards. So potential dashboards that we could have in terms of public dashboards, we could have both district and school level information that people could look at. They could examine disaggregated test scores. They could look at discipline data, per pupil spending, student attendance, teacher attendance, class size. There are a variety of things that we could have available on our dashboards. The big thing I want you to remember is we will have both public access to dashboards with some drill down capability and internal dashboards where our school support officers and our principals can drill down within the dashboards all the way to the student level data. And now we'd like to provide you with some demonstrations. We would like to show you one dashboard that we're working on for our public dashboard here in Guilford County, and then we would like to show you some of the dashboards that the Oakland school system has. And I'm going to turn this over to Michael.
So we'd like to show you a few dashboards. The first dashboard is an example that we put together to show how we envision a public dashboard for Guilford County Schools to look.
Sharon McLeese has joined us, despite not feeling well today. Sharon, did you have anything you wanted to add?
We're having technical difficulty with this PowerPoint.
I apologize. We had it all pulled up before, and then somebody took it down.
We make a recommendation that we go on to the timeline and the cost, and then we can come back to that if the technical problems overcome. I give Michael a chance to work through the technical issue. So timeline.
So we are developing dashboards right now. We have in the district several licenses for what are called Tableau PCs. So on individual PCs, we are working on developing some of the dashboards that we'd like to have and putting together the data that we will need to have for our dashboards. Once we get our license for our server services, Tableau will come in and provide two-day trainings for Sharon staff and for staff in accountability and research that'll be crucial for us so that we will know exactly some of the kinds of things we can do and ideas on how to better do dashboards. We anticipate that when the new district website is up in January, that we will have our first public dashboards available at that point. We are hoping in February to have our first drill down internal dashboards for our principals and our school support officers. And then throughout this next year, we will be adding dashboards as we develop them. In terms of the cost, Tableau is giving us a 25% discount on the cost of this. For this first year, it will cost about $130,000. That includes all the server services, it includes their support, and it includes training for the staff and also cost for setting it up to begin with. After this, it will cost about $95,000 per year for the server services.
Scott, here, board action none. Is that because it was incorporated as part of a specific line item in the budget already? On this slide, it says board action none.
Right. It does not require board action. We are just sharing. The board had asked us to talk about how we will make data more transparent. So we are here just to share the tool with the board. If we can't use our demo, can we get on the internet to show Oakland's?
Sure.
Yeah, if we could just go and give an example.
Just to finish that, it is built into our budget.
It is.
Yes.
This is already built into the budget.
And yes. On the recurring, the 95,000 licensing and support, if there was additional staff training needed because of turnover personnel, is that included in the recurring as well?
We will be able to train staff ourselves after this year.
All right. So we won't have additional meetings.
Right.
As we all know, we sometimes have turnover in key positions, but we will be able to do that on our own. All right.
Are we unable to go to the internet?
Yeah, go ahead and ask that question, Pat.
The other school districts, as you've mentioned, what's been their biggest takeaway from the power and the success of a program like this that the community may want to be aware of as we move into this implementation?
Sure. When we went to Atlanta, Sharon McLeason and I went and visited, spent the day in Atlanta talking with them about their dashboards. And of course, there's two takeaways. One, it enables their community to easily access data about their schools, and they can look at individual schools. They can drill down, look at different particular student groups, and their community is engaged with that information. But their internal dashboards really allow, they have a structure similar to ours with school support officers, and it allows those school support officers to look at their schools, to drill down within their schools. It gives them a lot of information at their fingertips to work with their schools, and it does the same thing for principals.
And from what I've observed just casually in researching this, it uses a lot more graphics. It seems to me,
yes,
it's a lot more visual versus a lot of verbiage. Is that what you found?
It does use a lot of graphics, and we found what we liked about the Oakland dashboards is that along with their graphics, they have explanations for the community so that they can understand the data.
Yeah.
And so you can build that in also. For the drill down all the way to student level for our principals, they can drill down and actually export data into Excel files on particular groups of students that they're interested in working with.
And
so
those are
a lot of capability.
And so there's encrypted password protected levels, I guess, from
district. Yes, all the internal dashboards will be password protected. So only certain people within the district will be allowed to see those dashboards because you can drill down to students.
And has there ever been any evidence thus far of a crash or a data breach or anything like that that we may be aware
of? So our data remains here in the district. It does not get sent somewhere else. It stays here. We just link our workbooks that we develop on the server. We link our workbooks back to our data, but the data resides here. It does not leave our district.
Okay, thank you.
All right, any other questions? Diane.
We're trying to give you all more time.
But evidently the computer froze. So she's rebooting it.
Go ahead, Diane.
Mr. McCullough, will this be able to be used with the presentation that we saw yesterday on the one cards, or is this a separate system?
This is a separate system.
Okay, all right, thank you.
All right, Dina, do you have any questions?
No, I'm just really excited about this this program.
Byron, do you have any? Thank you, Dina.
So I have a question. Will we be incorporating the standalone self-service data preparation tool, the Project Maestro, with this model when the one is set to come out in 2017? Okay. So I pulled the Gartner report, G-A-R-T-N-E-R, and so it has the strengths and the cautions for Tableau, and I'll forward it to the superintendent. Some of the cautions I just want staff to be aware of and going forward to answer those questions, but that is one of mine if we're going to be using that, because one of the cautions was lack of complex data model support, and that's why Tableau's response to that was to release a standalone self-service data preparation tool in 2017 to address its customers' challenges with large and complex data.
So yes, the superintendent has that report. We mm-hmm. gave that report okay. to her already.
All right.
And that's really not so much an issue for us.
Yeah.
That's for people that are wanting to do complex data analyses using okay. Tableau. We do our data analyses pretty much with other software.
Gotcha. All right, thank you.
All right, how are we coming?
Coming,
okay. Well, we have one other thing we can skip to while you still work on this. Under board discussion, the inclement weather days policy was for the 2017-18 calendars is on the schedule. And let me turn this to the superintendent. I don't see Nora in the room. I'm not sure who has this item, but.
So on the calendar, if we go to that item.
Yeah.
We are simply removing one item, which is there is an inclement weather day scheduled during the last day of Ramadan, and that is incorrect. So we are simply moving that inclement weather day, removing it, so that we would not schedule a makeup day during a Muslim holy day.
All right, any questions or comments about this action, which is a correction to the calendar? We will, yes.
Correct the calendar by removing the inclement weather day.
And to be clear, the inclement day that we're referring to in this instance is on June 15th, 2018, which hopefully will not be required in any event. So, any further discussion on that? Anyone else have a question or comment?
Have there been any type of concerns from parents in the district about this day, or anything that we've not personally received?
The question was, have we received any concerns, complaints from parents that the board members might not have seen, but the district has received?
I think it's more an issue of, after reviewing the graduation and the discussions that were had, to really make sure that everything was being consistent. You know, I think the calendar committee had been aware of the date, but maybe was thinking that seventh day of a 180-day school year maybe wasn't as important, but after hearing all of the comments from our Muslim community, and certainly as administration, felt like, you know, that was an oversight that needed to be corrected.
Because I haven't received any, but I wanted to check to see if the district had.
All right, and this, again, the fact that we have this issue highlights the fact that the our schedule is in quite a straitjacket from the legislative prescriptions of when school must begin, when it must end, and it gives very, very little leeway in terms of trying to figure things out. And I hope that we can get some movement on that. I know we've been trying, and I'm hopeful we'll get some progress on that, which will be a good thing. Does anyone want to make it? Diane, you made a motion.
Yes,
I'm not
sir,
sure
did.
We got a second.
Did yes,
we
get
a
oh, second? Yes, you did.
Yeah, very good. Yes, thank you, Byron.
There's not that many of us here.
That has been observed by several. All right, so are we, I think we may need to clear the vote in order to vote. Thank you. All right, if everybody would go ahead and cast your vote on that motion, please. I'm ready. Dina, we're ready for your vote, please.
Yes.
Thank you.
It appears we are unable to get internet connection. Is that right? So.
All right, so this vote passes by a vote of 6-0. If we got internet connection, we will go forward. If we don't, we're going to have a motion for closed session next, whichever.
We can present this next month. It is just demonstrating the technology solution to the board.
It's a further demonstration that technology can really do this to you. Yeah. All right, so. All right, well, if you're on, let's go ahead and do it then.
Sorry for the delay.
And you're there, it's just not. I'm gonna close that down. Are we there? Hang on.
Oh, it's the projection. You have to duplicate the screen.
I closed the PowerPoint. Oh, I see. And I lost. Let's do this next month, I think. I lost the mouse again. So.
Computer froze again.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Byron, I'm going to turn to you if I could. We look forward to that presentation at some future time. We'd like to see it. Byron.
All right. I think question. T. Diane Bailey, did you have a question before I make the motion? You had your hand. Okay. All right. I make a motion that we go into closed session to preserve the attorney-client privilege.
All right, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, we will be back as soon as we take care of these closed session items, and then we will pick up on our next item, which will be the 2017 Ready Accountability Report, which really is the last significant item we have for tonight, but it is in fact a significant item. We're now back in open session. I believe our next item is the 2017 Ready Accountability Report.
Thank you, Chairman Duncan.
Thank you. Good evening.
I'd like to first thank Bay Love for his hours of support and preparation of this report. And I also just want to mention, I'm not going to be going over in detail every slide that's in the presentation. Some of the slides are there for your information. And some of them are similar slides. They're just about a different EOC or EOG subject, but the slides are very similar. So highlights for this year, to begin with, we have the highest graduation rate we've ever had. Our Science 8 proficiency is now above 70%. Our Science 5, Math 1, and English 2 proficiencies are all above 60%. We had large proficiency increases, 4 to 5 points, percentage points in grade 4 math and in math 1. And a big highlight is that we had better EVOS growth. We do have a number of opportunities for improvement. We have some of our EOCs and EOG proficiencies that are flat. And we have persistent gaps, and you will see that in our data. We have racial ethnic gaps, we have economically disadvantaged student gaps, we have limited English proficiency or English language learner gaps, and we have gaps with our students with disabilities. When we look at our class of 17, we had the highest four-year cohort graduation rate at 89.8%. We have almost reached that 90% pinnacle. We had 82% of our schools that had graduation rates of 90% or higher, and we had 11 schools that had graduation rates of 100%. We have outperformed the other large districts in North Carolina, and we are making some progress on closing gaps with our graduation rate. In this graph, you can see 10-year trends in terms of graduation rates with Guilford County Schools, the state of North Carolina, and the other large districts. And you can see we are the blue line at the top. And last year, Charlotte inched us out by 1/10 of a percentage point. This year, we have their graduation rate decreased and ours increased again, so we're higher than Charlotte. These rates and charts are here for you to look at. These just show 5 years, past 5 years for the other large districts and the state in North Carolina. You can see that we are higher than the other districts. This is 10-year trends in our racial ethnic gaps and graduation rates, and you can see that we are closing the gaps. And the way that we have been closing the gaps is we're increasing graduation rates for all our students. So our, for instance, our black population has increased graduation rates over the past 10 years by 15 percentage points, and the Hispanics have increased by just about that same amount. We have decreased gaps by 10 percentage points between our black and white students. These are our schools that have the 100% and 90% graduation rates. That's for you to look at. Since we have many new board members, I wanted to quickly go over the parts of the accountability model. So we have certain indicators in the model for all schools, and the proficiencies for all schools are based on EOG and EOC assessments. They're based on grades 3 through 8, English language arts, grades 3 through 8, math, grades 5 and 8, science, math 1, biology, and English 2. In case you aren't familiar, students are given an achievement level based on their scale score. And the achievement levels run from level 1 to level 5. If you are a level 3, you're considered to have a sufficient command of whatever the subject matter is, and you're considered grade level proficient. Obviously, if you're a 4 or 5, you're grade level proficient also, but 4 and 5 are considered college and career readiness standards. You're proficient. You're on track for college and career readiness. Each school is given a performance composite, and the district is given a performance composite. And the performance composite is the grade level proficiency performance, that is the percent of all assessments that were scored at level 3, 4, or 5. For college and career ready performance composite, it is the percent of all assessments that were scored at level 4 or 5. So the indicators for each school are their school, they get a school performance grade. 80% of the school performance grade is based on grade level proficiency. 20% is based on EVAS school accountability growth. And so they get a score from 0 to 100. It's on a 15-point scale, and that's where the A, B, C, Ds, and Fs come from. High schools have additional indicators beyond what elementary and middle schools have. So added into their achievement scores are their four-year cohort graduation rate, the ACT proficiency, which for our high schools, all grade 11 students in North Carolina take the ACT, and it's the percent of grade 11 students at the school who score a 17 or higher on the ACT. The 17 is the minimum score you need to get into a UNC system school. We also have the percent of CTE concentrators who score at the silver level or higher, their silver, gold, and platinum on the ACT work keys. And the final indicator for high schools is math course rigor, and that is the percent of students in the graduating class who have had a higher level math course, like a math 3 or something higher. And just so you have some context about the North Carolina proficiency standards, there was a mapping study done in 2015 that mapped state standards to the NAEP assessment. And in the 2015 study, our new standards were rated a B for rigor. In the past, our state has been rated basically a C minus, anywhere from a C minus to an F. But even though our standards are much more rigorous now, we are currently ranked number 41 among the 51 states and the District of Columbia. This just gives you an example of a question that's more rigorous, and just what I wanted to point out, for instance, this English language arts question asks, what is the effect of the simile in this paragraph? And in the past, what students would have been asked to do is to say which line was a simile in, just to identify where a simile was. This is much more rigorous to talk about the effect that the simile is having. And the same thing, here's a sample math question, much more rigorous than the kinds of questions students got in the past. This slide just gives you a brief description of some of the abbreviations that are going to be used in this presentation. So GLP stands for grade level proficiency, CCR is college and career ready proficiency, EDS is economically disadvantaged students, LEP, limited English proficient, or more recently we're using English language learner. SWD is for students with disabilities, and AIG for academically intellectually gifted students. So overall, since we've had the new performance standards that came into effect in the 2012-13 academic year, you can see that we have been increasing both our grade level proficiency and our college and career ready proficiency. The increases have been slow, but we have been increasing. Here we compare our grade level performance composite for our district to the state and to the other large districts in North Carolina. And while Charlotte and Wake have higher performance level composites than we do, we have had more growth from 2016 to 2017 in our grade level composite. We have gone up almost 1 percentage point. Wake has decreased, Charlotte has stayed the same, and Cumberland and Forsyth have had smaller increases than we have had. We see almost the same thing when we look at our college and career ready performance composites. Both Charlotte and Wake have had decreases in their performance composites. Cumberland has remained the same. Forsyth has had a very small increase, and we've increased almost a half a percentage point. Here we look at grade level performance composites for certain groups, student groups. The first one is by race and ethnicity. And as you can see here, the state has a higher performance composite than we do for all students. And they have much higher, quite a bit higher, for Asian students than we do, but our Black and Hispanic students are doing about the same as the state as a whole, and our white students are doing slightly higher than the state as a whole. When we look at some of our other student groups, our economically disadvantaged students are not doing as well as in the state, but our English language learners are doing about the same as state. Our students with disabilities are doing slightly lower than the state, but our academically intellectually gifted students are doing similarly to the state. Now we're going to talk about our reading English language arts proficiencies for grades 3 through 8. At this point, all grades have proficiencies above 50%. And the overall grade level proficiency for grades 3 through 8 did increase, and we saw increases in grades 5 through 7. However, we still have gaps. Again, we have gaps with race and ethnicity, with gender, and with our other student groups. This shows you 3 years worth of our grade level proficiencies for each grade 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and at the far right, grades 3 through 8 combined for reading. And you can see that grades 5, 6, and 7 had increases last year. In fact, our only grade that decreased was the third grade. That was the one grade that was not included in our new reading program. Here we can see, if we look at our gaps for our different racial ethnic student groups, we can see that the gaps are not changing over time. I talked before about achievement levels. This graph shows you the achievement levels, levels 1 through 5, for our different racial ethnic student groups. Level 1s are the red at the bottom of each bar, and you can see that our Black and Hispanic groups have many more students at level 1, this is with reading achievement, than our other groups. So what we see with our data is that within each racial and ethnic group, so within each group, we see gaps for gender, for free and reduced lunch, for LEP and SWD. But after controlling for some of these other factors, we still see the racial ethnic gaps. So for example, when we look at gender, so if you look at this gender gap, there is a gap between Hispanic females and Hispanic males of about 8 percentage points. There's a gap between white females and white males of about 5 percentage points. However, when you look at white females versus Hispanic males, there's a gap of almost 30 points. And even though females, for the most part, outperform males, our white males are outperforming both the Hispanic males and Hispanic females. So again, you see that we still have, when you look at each of the red bars that represents females, you can see the racial differences, and the same thing when we look across at the bars that represent our male students. With poverty, which we measure by our free and reduced lunch, we do know that this is an underestimate at this point because some of our schools use the community eligibility provision, and so students don't apply for free and reduced lunch. So in those schools, sometimes we have an underestimate of the students who really are economically disadvantaged. But again, we see when we look at the poverty and racial ethnic gaps, you can see that our Black students who are not economically disadvantaged are outperforming the Black students who are economically disadvantaged by about 20 points. Our white students who are not economically disadvantaged are outperforming our white students who are economically disadvantaged by almost 30 points. But again, you can see that the white students who are not economically disadvantaged are outperforming the Black students who are not economically disadvantaged by almost 30 points.
The 51.1 here for the EDS, and then the 80.6 for white for the not EDS, and the Black 52.1 not EDS, and then the green 31.6 for the EDS.
So, if you look at, see Black, the 52.1, then mm-hmm. they're not economically disadvantaged mm-hmm. compared to white students who are not economically disadvantaged at 80.6. That's almost a 30-point gap. Both of those mm-hmm. groups are not economically disadvantaged.
But the Black not economically disadvantaged are outperforming the white that are economically disadvantaged by less than, what, 1.1%?
Right. And this is the first time we've seen that. In the past, we've seen
yeah.
that they generally are lower. The Black not economically disadvantaged are usually lower than our white group that is economically disadvantaged. But this year, they're basically the same.
Hmm. Yeah, that's why we need one. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Bennett.
Sure. We then examined proficiency for all our groups by the percentage of white enrollment at the schools. Generally, when you look at proficiency for all groups, we find that it's lower when schools are less integrated. And this is supported by national research that has shown that students of color perform better on standardized assessments, have improved graduation rates, et cetera, when they're in schools that are integrated. And as you can see here in this chart, as we go from the left side of the chart, 10% white enrollment, to the white side of the chart, which is about 80+% white enrollment, as we move to have schools that are more integrated, all groups perform better. And you can see the same thing here. This is presenting the data by the levels. So if you look at the less integrated schools on the left, you can see we have far more students who are performing at level one there than we do on the right side of the chart at the more integrated schools. And that's true for all student groups. All student groups do better. So when we look at our English language learners, we see again that we have gaps within each racial group. So if you look at our Asian students, the Asian students who are not limited English proficient or not English language learners, they are outperforming the Asian students who are English language learners by about 50 points. And we see the same thing with the Hispanic students, a big gap between the non-English language learners and the English language learners. But again, if you look at students who are not English language learners, not LEP, we see racial gaps there. Our white students are outperforming the other groups. When we look at our students with disabilities, again, we see similar results. So within each ethnic group, we see that, for instance, white students who are not students with disabilities versus white students that are, there's about almost a 50-point gap between those students. And we see that for our black students also. There's a big gap, about 30 points, between our black students who are not considered students with disabilities versus our black students with disabilities. But again, if you look across and you compare just students who are not disabled, you see that our white students are outperforming everybody else. And in fact, our white students who are considered students with disabilities are outperforming all the other racial groups of students with disabilities.
I just want to make sure I'm standing. So if you're black and you're in Guilford County and based on the 2017 EOG reading level, whether you had a disability or whether you did not, you are still behind Asian, white, and Hispanic.
Yes, sir. I also wanted to share with you our data. You know, our third grade students take what's called the beginning of grade reading test. This is part of Read to Achieve. And it's basically another form of the EOG that's given to all third graders at the beginning of the year. This chart shows you how our students performed on that test in relation to how they performed on the EOG. We have many students who score level one. You can imagine at the beginning of grade, they're going to score at level one. So we broke the level ones down into the lowest level ones, the middle level ones, and the highest level ones. And if you look across the top row, it shows you in the yellow what percentage of all the black students who scored level one at the beginning of the year actually were proficient at the end of the year on the EOG. It was 2.3%. If you go across further on that row, you see that 3.1% of Hispanic students who were lowest level one at the beginning of the year passed the EOG, but almost 10% of white students did. And as you look across each row, students who start at the same place at the beginning of the year, their outcome at the end of the year depends on their race.
I don't think I understand what you just said.
Could you review that one again, Dr. Penny?
Sure. So we were looking at where students were at the beginning of the year and how predictive that is of how they're going to do on the EOG at the end of the year. And these bands, the rows going across, represent students who start at the same level. And what we see is students who start at the same level, if you are white, you have a much greater chance than a Black or Hispanic student of passing the EOG, even though you started at the same place at the beginning of third grade?
Okay, are these children being taught by the same teacher? I mean, I guess part of my question is that then if the children are if they have available to them the same instruction in the same room, why is there such a difference? Or is the teaching not, it's almost as if you, if I understand what you're saying that Black and Hispanic students are less able to just comprehend than white children?
No, I'm not saying that.
Okay, I'm asking. I didn't say you said it.
I'm just saying there is a difference in their performance at the end of the year. I think, you know, Nakia may be able to talk more about why that is. My speculation would have to do with...
I think at the heart of your question is, why does a racial achievement gap exist, even when students come in at the same place, which is an age-old question, and how are we dealing with that gap when students come in the same place? But you also raised another good point. You said the instruction is the same.
Yeah,
that's not acceptable for every student. Every student in a classroom is different. And at the heart of addressing student needs is making sure we address the different needs of students. So if the instruction is exactly the same for all students, you're not going to end up with equitable results, because equity is giving students what they need. And I think that Chairman Duncan is going to recommend, and I know Board Member Hayes is agreeable to this, that we actually have a more in-depth discussion of this during the Achievement Gap Committee, and that I think you're recommending the board accept this report after going through this, but that we actually go through in-depth discussion about why these racial achievement gaps exist.
I think having a work session that's set up that way will give us set up a time when all members can attend. We are also missing several members tonight for various reasons in terms of their schedules. That I think it'd be helpful if we could, after we digest this, we're going to all have more questions even after we digest it, and then we can sit down in a work session with that committee and go through it. Okay. So I think Dr. Contreras would like us to do that as well.
Well, can I ask you a question,
sure.
Dr. Hardy?
Okay. Dina, hold on 1 second.
I'm sorry.
Dina was going to say something on the phone.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I definitely want to discuss this further in the Achievement Gap Committee meeting, and then maybe a work session after that, because I get really concerned, and I expressed this with Dr. Zhang when he was there, and one of the sort of things we worked on together was, it's not presenting data without contextual information, so that she and Monica would try to present together, because just putting this out there is very reckless. It affirms a lot of narratives out there about, you know, no matter how kids of color, African American kids show up, whether they're disadvantaged, whether economically disadvantaged or have some developmental or learning disability, no matter what it is, just can't measure up. And so I just think it's harmful to put this out here without some of that other information. The equitable instructional issue seems to not be a problem for white kids who are poor. There's a substantial gap between white kids who are not economically disadvantaged and white kids who are economically disadvantaged. And as Byron said, that in reading, their African-American kids not economically disadvantaged are almost on par with white kids who are economically disadvantaged, but white kids are outperforming Black kids who are not economically disadvantaged, and they are in both math and science. And so, and I bet if we had English language learners and all of the other identities and issues that kids come to school with, challenges that kids come to school with, race is going to continue to present a problem. And I've asked, you know, several department heads when they come, are you, when you share this information with schools, one, do they know it? And two, what are their explanations for it? And if you don't have that information, one, I don't know if you're sharing it with them. They can't do something about something they can't see. And two, you don't have an opportunity to interrupt their, those narratives that I think are contributing to the under-identification for gifted and talented, the inappropriate scheduling when kids are either testing appropriately in a certain level course, the disproportionate discipline consequences that are distributed to African-American kids. All of those things play into this. So, it, you know, to continue just to present this data and just leave it out there, to me, is very dangerous.
All right.
And I hope that going forward that we decide that we are going to present achievement data with some more supplemental supporting information so that people will be guided directly.
All right, so thank you for those comments. I'm going to go back to Diane. I'm not sure I finished hers, but I think the gist of your comment is you support that we accept the report, but then delve into it in greater detail at the next work session through the Achievement Gap Committee. Did I hear your thought process
yes.
correctly? Thank you, Diane. When you finish your point, thank you for letting that get in.
Okay. And you probably don't have an answer for this, but is there a way for you to see or know if a class of students are being taught by white female teacher or a white or a black female teacher or, you know, okay. Is there some, I mean, because in me, it's like what you're saying here is that there's a reason that these kids are not getting this. And if they're in the same classroom, if the same material is being given to them, and if the same opportunities for children who may not be reading on that level to get these kind of help, I don't quite understand why they're not getting it, okay? Or basically why the gravy's not sticking to the rice.
It does go back to what our superintendent was also expressing, and that there has to be differentiation. So there have to be instructional strategies that are used to assist each and every child, depending on where they start, so that they can learn and access the content. And I don't want to speak to Dr. Penny. I don't want to, in terms of the chart, but this is not, all of these students are not in the same classroom with the same teacher. So these are all of the students across the district who scored in that particular band.
I understand that, but I guess my point is that if we looked at it, looked at classrooms and looked at what was going on there, it seems like to me the results, regardless of whether you lump everybody in one pot or whether you're taking them by classes or by schools, so why is this disconnect there? I guess that's what I'm trying to ask.
No, the first thing is the instruction isn't the same in all classrooms.
Okay.
And that's one of the areas we're trying to address. I think, again, I just want to stress that this discussion is so very important, and we want to make sure we answer your questions in depth and address the concerns being raised during the Achievement Gap Committee. So I would ask that we complete the report and that you start sending the questions to Dina Hayes and to me so we can be prepared to address some of the concerns that you have.
Well, Madam Superintendent, may I ask if staff has time? May I ask if staff has the time? I'd like to have a one-on-one.
Sure.
Thank you.
All right. And I think you'd make time for any board member to
Absolutely.
Try to go over the data even before we get to the meeting. I feel sure you would do that.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. All right, so let's go ahead and finish going through so we can have the opportunity to digest this data and think it through for the preparation for the
sure.
Achievement Gap Committee meeting.
So when we look at math in grades 3 through 8, we see that grades 3 through 6 have proficiencies that are above 50%. And the overall grade level proficiency for grades 3 through 8 math did increase. We did have an increase in grade 4 math of 4.5 percentage points from 2016. And Alan, I'm pleased to let you know that was statistically significant gain.
And I would concur, clearly is.
We still see gaps, though, for race, ethnicity, for gender, and for our other student groups. So when we look at math over 3 years for each of the grade levels, what we see is we saw a slight decrease in grades 3. We saw that nice significant increase in grade 4. Grades 5 and 6 and 8 pretty much stayed the same. Grade 7 had a slight increase. And overall, we have a very slight increase when you combine all the grades together. Grade 4 was our outlier sort of this year. But again, if we look at over time, our achievement gaps, we see that they are persistent. They're flat. They're not changing. We're not decreasing the gaps. And this is the same chart that we saw for reading, where you can see we have many more students of color that are at level 1 compared to our white students. That's our lowest achievement level. And I'm not going to go through all of these. We see the same things we saw with reading. We see gender gaps, but we still see racial and ethnic gaps. Same thing with poverty. Same thing where we see increases in performance for all student groups as our schools become more integrated. And again, less integrated schools have many more students at level 1 for each one of our racial ethnic groups, and better performance as the schools become more integrated for each of the racial ethnic groups. Saying the same thing here with our English language learners. And I will point out that the English language learners in general perform a little bit better on math, as you might expect, than they do in reading. Same thing with our students with disabilities. When we look at science for grades 5 and 8, grade 8 increased so that it's our highest proficiency level now at above 70%. But again, we have gaps that persist. You can see here that over time, grade 5 was increasing, had a slight decrease this past year. Grade 8 has been improving each year. The racial gaps are not disappearing. Every group is increasing in terms of the proficiency, but their distance from each other is not changing much. And again, with science, you know, we have the higher proficiency there, so we have fewer students who are scoring at level 1 across all the groups, but our black students had the most level 1s. And again, we see the same gaps. Basically, our girls are doing better than our boys. We see the poverty gaps. And because we have lower numbers, when it's just grade 5 and 8, we don't really have enough to show the LEP and the SWD gaps. When we move to high school for our EOCs, we saw an increase in our Math 1 and our English 2 proficiencies. And both of those increases were statistically significant. Math 1 increased by 4 percentage points. But again, we see persistent gaps. So you can see our Math 1 improved, our English 2 improved a little bit, biology pretty much remained the same. We see similar results to what we saw with the EOGs when we disaggregate all our data. I'm only going to present the biology data because that's our lowest proficiency level. But in your addendum to this PowerPoint, you have the gaps for Math 1 and for English 2. I mean the graphs, I'm sorry.
I have a question, Dr.
Sure.
You're saying more integrated, and on the graphs and charts is looking just as more white. Is there a different terminology used with the integrated versus just more white?
Well, as you get to like 50% white, you've got a more integrated school because you also have 50% students of color. So in the middle of those graphs going across, you're going to greater integration of schools.
So is, I mean, is that what is that the correct term? Because if you have more than 51% white in the school, it's predominantly white. It's more white. I guess it's a half glass empty, half glass full type situation.
Well, yeah, compared to our schools that have 10% white enrollment and 90% students of color, those other, as you're moving down the chart, we do have more integration.
But see, but the terminology that I hear in a lot of these presentations is that we say predominantly black, or, you know, or more black or more people of color schools. We don't say, you know, we don't say moderately integrated or a little bit integrated when we come to a school that's almost autonomously people of color. So I'm just getting the verbiage, trying to understand the rationale for the verbiage. You explained it. That was a statement, not a question. Okay. I just want to understand that, because if it's 51% more white, it's a more white school. Right. It's how I interpret it, more white. There's an integrated. I'm like, you know, we, you know, okay.
So when we look at biology over time, again, we see the gaps are just not improving there, stable over time. Again, we see when we look at level of proficiency, we see that our Black and Hispanic groups have many more, there are many more students at level one, which is our lowest achievement level. And again, we see the same thing here. We have the gender gaps with our girls performing better than our boys, but we also have the racial ethnic gaps. Same thing with the poverty gaps. We see the gaps within each group for the students who are economically disadvantaged and the students who are not, and then we see the racial ethnic gaps across those groups. Same thing with our LEP status and our students with disability. When we look at the other performance indicators for our high schools, we look at ACT. So if you'll notice that basically the state and all districts had lower ACT scores this year, or lower percentage of students who met that criteria of a composite score of 17, except for Forsyth County. They were the only school that only district that saw an increase. So while we saw a decrease, that seemed to be common across the state, that there were decreases in ACT performance. When we look at our school performance grades, as you can see, we have reduced our D's and F's in the district. We had 48 the first year of the school performance grades, and we're down to 42 this year. We've increased our C's and increased our A's and B's also. We had 42 schools who were identified as low performing in the first year that the state designated low performing schools. That was reduced to 40 last year and 38 this year. Now, it's not that we're reducing two schools each year. What's happening is we are having some schools who are coming off the low performing list and other schools who are going on. So in 16-17, we had 9 of the 40 schools who came off the low performing list, but 7 went back on. So that was a net reduction of 2. And the same thing happened this year. We had 7 schools who came off the list and 5 schools who went back on. Or went on the list. So we had a net reduction of 2 again. So we wanted to look at our low performing schools in terms of their performance grades. And as you can see, in the first year that we had low performing schools, 12 of our low performing schools had F. This year, only 6 of our low performing schools had F. So our schools are doing a little bit better. We have more D's instead of F's. When we look at across the state and the district, the state had an increase in low performing schools this year. If you see, Charlotte went from 25 schools to 40 schools this past year. Wake doubled the number of low performing schools that they had. Cumberland increased the number of low performing schools. We had a slight decrease, and Forsyth County had quite a bit of decrease in their low performing schools. This is just for your information. You approved at the last board meeting that we use the alternate accountability model C for our alternative schools, and they get ratings of either maintaining, declining, or improving. And as you can see, the very first year, everybody was given maintaining. That was the baseline year. Almost all our schools get the maintaining. Last year, we had one school, Pruitt Scale, that was declining. This year, we had one school that was declining. So our good news is our EVOS growth. We've had improvement in our EVOS growth since 2013 with the new standards. We have more schools that are exceeding growth and fewer schools that are not meeting growth. And if you look here, in 2013, about two-thirds of our schools, 67% of our schools, met or exceeded growth. This past year, 86% of our schools met or exceeded growth. And we want to brag on some of our schools. Kaiser Middle School had the fifth highest EVOS growth in the state. And Northeast High, had the 11th highest EVOS growth in the state. And if we look at, there were 2,532 schools that had EVOS ratings in the state.
Your principal that year is here to take a bow.
He's right out there. So the top 10% of schools is about 253 schools. Top 10% in North Carolina, 20 of that top 10% were Guilford County schools. And when we look at other large districts, we see that if you look at the red are the percentage of schools that did not meet growth, green the percentage that met growth, and the blue the percentage of schools that exceeded growth, you can see that we're doing better than the state and the other large districts in terms of growth. And this is just to let you know how we're doing in particular grades and subjects. We are not meeting growth in third and fourth grade reading and eighth grade math. We are meeting growth in fourth and seventh grade math, and in all other subjects and grades, we are exceeding growth. And this is just for your information. We list out our schools that exceeded expected growth last year, our high schools, our middle schools, and our elementary schools. So in summary, our opportunities for improvement are that we have flat proficiencies in some of our EOC and EOG levels, but we do have persistent gaps. Areas we want to build upon are that we did have highest graduation rate ever, that we have had some increases in our grades 3 through 8 reading and math, that our science proficiency is high, and that we had a nice increase in Math 1 and English 2. We had a large proficiency increase in Math 1, that we are having better EVOS growth, and that our rate of improvement in our district is exceeding the rate of improvement in the other large districts.
All right, thank you very much. As we've indicated, we're going to hit the pause button here tonight. Dan, I won't cut you off if you want to ask something, but we're going to pick up this discussion in a much deeper sense once we got a chance to study this information, plus the information in the addendum that's been provided, the addendum information as well. Diane, please.
I'll try to be real quick, and I won't expect you to give me an answer, but okay, you said, I think, that we had a 90% graduation rate, right?
Almost 90%, 89.8%.
All right. Do we know how many of those who graduated had what their GPAs were? You know, what percentage of that group had GPAs that were lower than 2.5? If you just want to jot.
I don't have that now, all but right. We can get
and then
that for you.
I also would like wonder if you know what are the predicted outcomes if a kid has, say, a 2.5, 3.0, et cetera, as far as, you know, because I think it's important for, as parents are looking at this and trying to encourage their kids to work harder and everything, is that if a child who has a 2.0 but graduates, but they're not going to be able to get a job at McDonald's, but a child who graduates with a 2.5 is able to enter some college or community without media. You see what I'm saying? so that becomes valuable to them in encouraging their children to perhaps achieve more or something like that.
We are working on that report. It was originally asked for by Board Member Gladden. What you have in front of you is simply the accountability report, but we are completing the follow-up report.
We will have
in January, we will have information about our 2017 graduates and their college attendance.
All right. Okay, well, and then the next one has to do with something that the superintendent had mentioned in her speech yesterday and today about, you know, kids in different, I don't think we want to use the word tracks, but like our STEM students versus our college prep students versus our general students. Do we have some idea of what that looks like? Because you mentioned it in your speech about, you know, how many kids were going into STEM or going into career planning, that kind of
our
stuff.
Our career technical education.
Yes, we do have work keys
data.
Right, and I think if we had that, then we can look at how soon guidance counselors perhaps are, guidance counselors are perhaps, you know, directing kids earlier to see if they go there. And I don't know whether this is an appropriate question or not, but are the tests that our kids taking biased?
So the state runs statistical analyses to detect bias. It's called differential item functioning. Okay. And in general, so when they were developing these tests, they have lots of items because we have multiple forms of each test. So we have about 600 items. For instance, for ELA grade 3, ELA grade 4, 600 for each of those. Out of those, I looked up the information about the number of items that DIF detected were biased, either male, female, or racial, ethnic bias. The most I saw was about 14 items out of 600 that were identified as being biased. Those items are removed.
Okay. Then my next question has to do with, do we know why we saw the uptick in schools that came off of the FD list? Again, you don't have to answer this now, but I'm just saying, if we got some best practices here that we need to, you know, model for getting the rest of our schools there, I just wanted to know, do we know why? Then on the page where you had the indicators, I don't know what my question was, but maybe I'll remember when I see you directly. But the next one has to do with reading. The page you have for reading, okay, how is the new reading program that you have implemented, will it help to make that better? Do you understand what I'm asking?
So we are hoping that will be the case. When you implement a new program like that district-wide, we were actually expecting the proficiencies in reading to go down this year, because it's new teachers are teaching new content, a new program. And we were pleasantly surprised to see that our reading proficiencies did not go down in grades 4 through 8.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Byron, I think you had something.
Yes, thank you all again. I'm very grateful for a work session on this information. There's just so many things that really just should be from a board to superintendent in terms of memorandum of understanding when it regards to race and just so like that. So I didn't realize it was a number of 95 slides. I'll just make a comment. I'll email all my questions. We'll follow up the board. But what I would like to see, because I've received a number of phone calls in the past 2 weeks, our principals don't know this data. And from my understanding, our SSOs have not gotten copies of this data per all of their schools. So they should all really have a stack.
Really?
I mean, yeah, exactly. That's something I would like to see, is for them to know what is the race and breakdown for each school that they supervise, because our principals, some of our principals are referring to public information requests. They don't have the context. They don't have the PowerPoint. They don't have the data. And if parents are asking and wanting to know what is racially going on in my school, from the principal standpoint, they should be able to interpret this data and be able to educate and empower that parent. And that's something I would like to see within the next year as a timeline, that we are empowering our principals and our SSOs to have this type of data where they're seeing what the snapshot of their school and what it looks like from race and from data and academics and everything else, because I'm sure you're not getting flooded with questions about what does race look like in my school. And that's something that we should be focused on, and as well as having one-on-ones with you, Dr. Penny, and Dr. Harding, and Superintendent Contreras, when it comes to race as a board. It is disappointing. I'll be transparent and disappointing that when it comes to presentations, and I have sat through 8 months worth, the minorities on this board are leading and being the most aggressive and the most inquisitive when it comes to regarding race in our community. And I don't know if other board members that are on this board are silent because of disinterest or disconnect. And so I feel that by leading with and following those questions that everyone may not feel comfortable in asking on this board, because we have to see race as a board. We have to see race as a board. And if we're all not inquisitive about the knowledge that's going on or catching the changes and the percentage points that Alan points out, you know, constantly about this, if we're not seeing race, that is an issue. We are a majority African-American people of color district. So regardless of what reasons we ran for this board and the particular interests and issues that our individual districts represent, we have to care about race, because race is at the root of everything that we do. And Dina Hayes Green has constantly said, our district is run off the backs of poor black and brown children. Yet we are silent as a majority about what is going on with race in Greensboro. We concern ourselves with graduation. We concern ourselves with dollar amounts. We concern ourselves with Amazon and mattress costs. We don't ask about race as a board. And that is a problem in an African-American majority community. And I want to know why. It's either disinterest or disconnect.
Thank you, Mr. Glutton. I just want to make sure that you know that all SSOs have this data and extensive report. The principals have had this. So if someone tells you they have not received a presentation on this, they're being disingenuous. They have the report as well, and their school improvement plans come from the data. We've been doing something new this year, and the SSOs, because they have a manageable number of schools, have been doing individual reviews of the school improvement plans. We've been doing race equity training in the schools, and Bay Love is coming to do the deep racial analysis he did at the last Achievement Gap Committee with groups of principals. So we're not going to bring all 125 of them together at one time. We're actually meeting with them in small groups so that they are more aware. With respect to the board, I can't answer board questions, but certainly I want you to know we are doing more than ever than we've done in the past on deep data analysis and trying to get to root causes and strategies that work for 100% of our students.
And I just wanted to say, you have in the attachments, you have a report that's a disaggregated report for the district. It shows proficiencies in all grades and subjects broken out by different student groups. Principals have that same report for each one of their schools, and the SSOs have those reports.
Okay. Because with that, I see a lot of colors, but I'm not seeing color consistently through the presentation. And that's disaggregated, as Dina is constantly hammering, and gosh, I can hear in my ear right now about a lot of things. But we're getting there, and I'm very supportive of the presentation, and it is a process, and we'll be very clear on that. But you know, we have 14 attachments about, you know, this ready report, and that is a lot to go through and then understand. And so, and I mean no disrespect to my fellow board members that are here, not here. It is a lot of data. As an African-American male, I struggle to understand all the colors and the color. So I really want to make sure that we provide opportunities for people, whether they may not feel comfortable and bold up here, but they can one-on-one have that conversation about what the data is that they see.
All right, thank you very much for the starting this process. I know that Superintendent's office will coordinate the timing of the work session with the Achievement Gap Committee and work with members, because we want to have as wide availability as we can for that important discussion. Diane, you had something else?
Well, I just want to ask, do you do anything as far as looking at our athletes and where they are, you know, how many? Because one of the things that bothered me when we had the recognition of our football team is that out of the 21 young men that came up here at that time, only 7 of them knew whether or not they were going to college. And I understand that everybody who plays football or athletics isn't necessarily going to college, but at the same time, I think that, you know, we emphasize so much extracurricular activities and how that should play into this young person's life as they move forward. So
remember, when we honor our teams, there's a lot of underclassmen there, so they won't have a college choice.
But, no, that particular, I think if I recall, he said that there were 21 seniors, or maybe I'm wrong with that number. And I just want to make sure that our kids are, one, performing, you know, academically, two, and not just, you know, athletically, and then where they wind up falling as far as, you know.
Unfortunately, we don't have any data capture of students who are participating in athletics that we can tie to this other data.
Okay. All right. But it might be something worth looking at.
The State High School Athletic Association, because there's competitions for who has the highest grade point level in each sport for various schools around the state, I think there is some data generated for that for each sport. Mm-hmm. Because there's, at least there used to be, where they would comment that the cross-country team at Smith High School had the highest GPA of all the cross-country teams in the state, or, you know, those kinds of things. There's some data out there about that.
Yeah, I think the schools calculate that and send that in, but I will check on that and see if there's any way
right.
we can get that information.
I'm sure the State High School Athletic Association will share. This is data I do. That's the only data I know about, but there is that.
Thank you.
All right, thank you all very much. On reports from the chair, this is the annual time when we have upcoming the North Carolina School Board Association meeting, and we get four votes at that meeting, given the size of our district. We have a long-standing tradition, if you're not here at this meeting, that you can become voted in as a delegate for the meeting. But we like to take volunteers first who would like to go. And last year, I know we had several people who were happy to volunteer and go. Diane. So Diane is a delegate. Others who would like to, Pat. Pat would volunteer, so we have two. Anyone else would like, Byron, so we have three. There's four, so we have three volunteers already. And so is anyone else who's here like to volunteer as the fourth? All right.
Linda usually attends.
I do, yes. Bear with me and I'll. You know, I said I do, but they're not on this particular form. Can we get the dates out to the three who have volunteered to make sure that that works on their calendar? And then we'll elicit our, Linda usually signs up and goes to that for one, I know. So, with the approval of the board, they'll be our delegates so long as the dates work on everyone's calendar. Thank you for that. And that concludes the report from the chair tonight. That's always an important item. I'm a little disappointed we didn't get to get as many people who weren't here with it, but that just in the sense that we've done that before on occasion. But thank you very much to the people volunteering and going. Board comments. Diane, we'll start with you.
Okay, I'll try to run through these very quickly. First of all, I'm very proud of our ribbon cutting for Hunter Elementary yesterday, and I am really thrilled, you know, from the historical standpoint that we were able to preserve some of the different pieces of the old school in a very unique way. I would have never thought to use them as art pieces, okay. or you know, so I'm glad that history is going to be there for them. I did get a chance to attend the GCEA meeting last week, and you know, I think that it's important for us to let our staff know in different ways, you know, that we support them and support what they're interested in. One of the things that they did present, and Madam Superintendent, I don't know if this has been put on the website or not, was about the workshops for immigrants on how to be safe. You remember that was presented? Mm-hmm. Okay, and so I hope that, you know, we let folks know that that is available to our families of immigrants, and that we are taking a proactive stance in trying to assist them in what seems sometimes to feel like a very frightening time, because every day with the media, we don't know who's going to get, you know, targeted for not being able to be in this country. I did attend the Pink in the Park today, and the only reason I bring it up is because breast cancer is something that affects a lot of people and our families, and I think that it's a good activity that kicks off Breast Cancer Awareness Month. So I encourage us to pay attention to that. I know that I referee volleyball, and I know some schools have wanted during that month to wear pink as a part of their uniforms to recognize that. The MWBE luncheon was very rewarding today. I feel very proud of the fact that we still have an MWBE in Greensboro, because in 2007, I threw myself on the table and said over my dead body because they wanted to get rid of it. And so the fact that we see what it's doing today is very important. And I cannot say enough kudos to our superintendent for her powerful, very knowledgeable, very important speech. At least she's not, sometimes you get speakers who come and they just say stuff to be fluffy. She doesn't. And I hope that the economic development community heard her message today, because if we don't understand that education and economic development are closely aligned, then we just don't understand what we're up here for. So I just wanted to give you that. I want to give a shout out to girls volleyball. I referee girls volleyball, but they don't get any coverage in the media, can't. So I really wish that, I mean, we got some fantastic volleyball players, and you know, we give all the coverage to the football team, but I mean, would y'all please come and cover a volleyball game? The girls do a great job. So I just wanted to give a shout out to our volleyball teams in all of our schools. For those of you who like to swim, the Learn to Swim program started this week. We started in High Point. Parkview and Kirkland Park are at Western Academy, and then PEC starts on Monday. And I'd like to say to you know, our kids and our parents, please, you know, let your kids participate in the Learn Swim program. It's going to be one of the most rewarding experiences that they have in their second grade year. I want to get in the pool with them, but I can't because I'm too sick. But I do want us to see that program go. And then the last thing is something I shared with the superintendent, and it's that for us to help our parents understand about books versus ebooks, and why perhaps kids are not bringing home books and homework, because, you know, that's something we need to deal with. And I think, Madam Superintendent, maybe there needs to be, you know, some other kind of explanation as to why that's happening. So that, you know, if you got parents asking about that, then that means that they really want to help their children. If their children are coming home and saying, I didn't have any homework, or I don't have a book, or, you know, whatever. We want to have that kind of participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pat.
Yes, I just want to echo in part what my colleague, Ms. Bellamy Small, mentioned with regard to Dr. Contreras and the Guilford Education Alliance forum they had, for lack of a better description, and the what's the real return on investment was Dr. Contreras really articulated the power of what good schools and what proficient students can mean for the economy, that the two are inextricably linked, and that I hope that many people were listening because it was quite impressive, the statistics that we learned, many of which were, I think, you would have to really dig to find. And so that was, I think that was very helpful for a lot of us. I mean, it's in the billions of dollars, and I think Wake County had a recent study that showed that. And so it gets back to some of the slides we were looking at earlier. And I think there's some things we can be proud of, which is very encouraging. I think there's, with the board we have as it's constituted now, and the community, folks that we have in the community, the business community, we've got a lot of momentum that we can leverage to increase the number that we have. We have an 89% graduation rate, but we only have a 46.5% college and career ready, and that's where we have to really focus our efforts, and I think we're doing that. And certainly the alarming statistics we have in our achievement gap issues. So I'm optimistic, and I know that we're all here to put children first, and so I'm encouraged about the future ahead for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Wes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like the minutes of this meeting to reflect that this board member is neither disinterested nor disconnected when it comes to serving the best interest of all 73,000 students in this district. So please be aware that any concerns that you may have about your individual students, about your individual schools, are always on my mind, and I stand ready to assist you in any way that I possibly can. And I'd like to echo the thoughts of Mr. Tillman and Ms. Bellamy Small. This district spends $700 million annually on educating students. And if you go to the GEA website and you call up the text of Dr. Contreras's remarks to that forum on Wednesday morning, you'll see her thoughts on the return on that investment. And it's very interesting reading. It was interesting hearing that presented in person, but I think that you'll find some points that'll strike home as we wonder how effective our dollars are being spent on preparing our students for life after school. So thank you for that, Dr. Contreras. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I want to thank Dr. Contreras for the summary of the Celebration of Excellence. It was a wonderful event she gave earlier in her superintendent's report, and it was a joyous occasion. It was a time of great celebration, and we should celebrate our educators for their great accomplishments, and so I'm thankful for that. I was not able to be in person at the speech Dr. Contreras gave, but I did have a chance to read the text, and I would say, in summary, it's important to note, and this has been true for decades and remains true now, that the number one driver of economic development in any community, anywhere in North Carolina or anywhere in the country, is the quality of your public education. It's the number one driver every time. So it continues to befuddle me when we are focused in this state on economic development, why we don't have the kind of investment of resources to support that one would think would follow when you have the truism that the number one driver of economic development is the quality of your public education. Comes up in every study, every report ever done. So thank you for that speech. It's important. It's an important subject matter. Byron, and I haven't forgotten you, Dean. I'm coming to you last.
Thank you. I would be remiss if I did not thank all the elected officials and candidates running for office and community members and parents and advocates, BLM, the anti-racism of BLM, for coming out and really speaking truth to power with a lot of what they said on tonight. I don't see how we can, you know, I know we have one more board member's comment left, but, you know, what tonight happened has just been, you know, accumulating and accumulating, you know, on this board. And in terms of the, you know, dysfunction that happens at times, as well as the fact that, you know, we hopefully will be going through our first board training and hopefully getting a better understanding of what our role is. It seems hypocritical that we demand of the superintendent and staff for children to be college and career ready, and we're not ready. So I definitely encourage and hope that we continue to excel in that. Being more loud doesn't make you any more true. However, I definitely want to uplift the speakers and all speakers that come out anytime, whether I agree with what you say or whether you don't. It is about holding accountable, being held accountable. I have not been privy to everything that is going on. I am looking into it. I hope that this board, you know, conducts an independent investigation of whatever accusations is going on with this board. I feel that we need to be transparent. You know, it's out there. The tea has been poured. The laundry has been hung. It is what it is, and we need to address it and move forward as a board. We have an obligation, and we are role models. I've had several parents say, you know, is this how you all behave? If this how, you know, you all do on the board, is this really what's going on? And the Board of Education, you know, historically has always run very, very low when it comes to media, and a lot of people mistake me for a commissioner or a city councilman because people don't know who we are. And now they not only know who we are, they know how we voted, they know the comments that we've said, they know the emails that we've sent, and they know our impressions and perceives of the superintendent. It is real. and we need to respond accordingly. We need to put personal issues aside. I am not exempt from that, and we need to work together because at the root of all that we do, it is for children. So I thank Councilwoman Dr. Goldie Wells for staying with us to the end. I saw Councilman the Honorable Melvin Skip Austin come in and out earlier. To everyone in the community that came out, High Point and Greensboro NAACP were present, as well as members of the Pulpit Forum, Delta Sigma Theta, and other various fraternities and sororities. Thank you all for coming out and responding. Pray for us as we pray for each other and work through our issues. And hopefully we will be the board that Guilford County expects us to be. I ran a campaign and I ran an election. I didn't run to be anyone's best friend, but what I ran is to be a part of a team that gets behind our quarterback, which is the superintendent, to run the play that produces the most equity and maximizes the most of our resources for this district. Thank you.
Thank you, Dina.
Thank you, Alan. I was going to pass until I heard your comment. So while I do believe that education is a very important driver and influence over economic development and economic situations or statuses in families, I also know that economic opportunities are drivers to educational success. And if we don't improve the economic situation of our families through our purchasing, procurement, our MWB, raising the wages of our lowest paid employee, then we're just perpetuating the cycle. Guilford County Schools is predominantly of color. The city of Greensboro is predominantly of color. And Guilford County is over 40% of color. And if we don't do better by these large populations of people of color in our community, we will continue to misallocate resources and make our problem worse. So I do think that we have got to get to the bottom of what is preventing people of color from having the kind of academic success, the economic success, so that they can thrive in our community. And I think we need to, pull our other partners, the county and the city and the universities and the businesses, and to understand that and focus on lakes and not just the fish fixing that we do. So I just feel like it's really important for people to understand that changing demographics in our city and our county, that we were not projected to become of color as soon as we did. But as I've said before, that Greensboro, out of the six major cities, is the first that has become majority of color. And those are the people who are having the worst outcomes, and what people experience in our school system has a lot to do with their opportunities in life. So we should take this very seriously.
All right, thank you for that excellent addendum to my comments, which if it were a friendly amendment, I would accept. So thank you for that.
You sure?
Diane, did you have something that you had?
I would be remiss if I did not thank the Greensboro City Council for the proclamation for the Melvin C. Swan Day, and I want to thank Councilwoman Goldie Wells for bringing it and delivering it to us. And Madam Superintendent, I hope that we can, have this to be framed and to hang at Swan. Okay, thank you.
Yes, we're most appreciative, and thank you for staying the length of the meeting as well. All right, do we have a motion to adjourn? Oh, sorry, excuse me. Let me retract that. Our board attorney has a quick matter to put on the record.
I would like to put on the record a settlement between the E. Drew Nelson versus the Guilford County Board of and others versus Guilford County Board of Education and others in the amount of $11,000.
Thank you. That does not require a vote. That's a matter
of being
put on the record.
No, it doesn't. It's
just an
announcement.
So that, your motion. Thank you. We have a second?
Second.
All in favor, please say aye. Aye. All right. Thank you all very much.
Thanks, Steve.